While the House was working on the troop withdrawal measure today, Defense Secretary Ashton Carter and Joint Chiefs Chair General Martin Dempsey were on Capitol Hill to talk about U.S. military strategy in the Middle East. They gave an update on efforts to train Iraqi security forces in their fight against ISIS. Last week, the president ordered 450 more troops into Iraq to assist in combating Islamic militants. Congressman Mac Thornberry chairs this hearing of the House Armed Services Committee. It's just under 3 hours.
Before we proceed, I want to make clear up front that the committee will not tolerate disturbances in these proceedings, including verbal disruptions, photography, standing or holding signs. And I want to thank all our guests at the outset for your cooperation. This committee meets today to hear from the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff on U.S. policy and strategy in the Middle East. I think we should acknowledge at the outset that this region is not subject to easy or simple solutions and has bedeviled statesmen of many countries for generations. Yet there is also a sense that we're at a particularly perilous time and that the U.S. policy and strategy is inadequate. Dr. Kissinger testified earlier this year before the Senate that in the Middle East, multiple upheavals are unfolding simultaneously. There's a struggle for power within states, a contest between states, a conflict between ethnic and sectarian groups, and an assault on the international state system. He further argued that especially in a time of global upheaval, the consequences of American disengagement is greater turmoil. It seems to me that that is what we are in fact witnessing. While President Obama admitted recently that there is not a complete strategy for dealing with ISIS, others argue that there may well be a strategy at work here, one of retrenchment and accommodation so that the U.S. plays a lesser role in the Middle East and elsewhere. U.S. military personnel are the most capable in the world, but I know of no one who thinks that 450 more in Iraq under current constraints will turn the tide against ISIS. Very concerning to me are recent press reports that in the midst of negotiations to remove sanctions related to its nuclear program, Iran is continuing to pay and equip the Taliban in Afghanistan as part of its regional efforts to sow instability and harm U.S. interests. When one factors in the chaos in Yemen and Syria, the uncertainty about the future direction of Turkey, the doubts about us from traditional allies such as Egypt and the Gulf nations, as well as continuing threats to our ally Israel, the plain hard facts show that the situation in the Middle East has deteriorated substantially in the last 6 years. What's worse, there seems to be nothing coming from the White House to change that trajectory. We cannot expect our distinguished witnesses today to answer for all the failures of the administration's approach to the Middle East over the last 6 years. We can and should expect, however, to hear the military component of a strategy to reverse this deteriorating trend and to protect American interests. My view is that there is no substitute for American leadership in the Middle East or anywhere else. That does not mean it's up to us to solve age-old disputes, but it does mean we cannot afford, for our own sake, to simply stand back. We must be strong, especially militarily strong, and we must be credible. Yield to the ranking member.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank Secretary of Defense and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs for joining us today and for their great work for our country. And I think the chairman in his first couple of sentences there adequately described the depth of the problem. With the number of failed states and, gosh, just the different battles that are going on there, it is an overwhelming problem that is creating a huge humanitarian crisis and a threat not just to the region, but to the globe. I will, however, disagree that the notion that a U.S. presence will solve the problem. I would hope that we would have learned over the course of the last 14 years of having a substantial U.S. presence in both Iraq and Afghanistan, that the West showing up in the Muslim world and saying we're here to solve your problems isn't going to get it done. And as far as the strategy is concerned, I believe we do have a strategy. I think what people are frustrated by is that that strategy, that U.S. strategy, does not simply solve the problem. And I've had a number of people complain to me about our lack of a strategy. I've asked every single one of them, okay, what should we do? Have not got an answer. as to what we should do that would solve the complex problems that the chairman described. So as we approach this, I hope that we are cautious about our confidence that U.S. military might can solve this problem, because I think that would make it worse and at great cost to us. What we have to do is tactically use the U.S. military to help the right people and move things in the right direction, not think that the more U.S. military we use, somehow the better the situation gets. I think that would be a very, very dangerous mistake. As far as the broader strategy, it's really simple on its face. We need to find Sunnis who are willing and able to fight ISIS and build a better alternative. And it's not just ISIS. I mean, if ISIS went away tomorrow, there would be a, another ideologically extremist violent group, just like, it was Al-Qaeda, still is, but now ISIS has seemingly eclipsed Al-Qaeda. It's not just a matter of defeating one group. It's a matter of defeating an ideology. Now, the one thing I will quibble with, and that I do want to hear from our two witnesses about our strategy, is in getting those Sunnis that would be willing to fight ISIS and present a more reasonable alternative in Iraq and Syria, certainly, but elsewhere as well, for the people over there, we are still relying on the Baghdad government. It is still our hope that there will be an Iraqi government that is sufficiently inclusive so that Sunnis will be willing to fight for it. I just don't see that happening. Starting with al-Maliki, they set up a very sectarian, separatist government that did everything to shove the Sunnis into the arms of ISIS. Now, I've not met al-Badi, but I have heard that he has a desire to change that. The trouble is, the people below him have no desire to change that. And he does not have the power simply to make them, the Minister of Defense, the Minister of Interior, the various Shia militias, Iran, change their minds. So as we continue to try and do that, I fear that strategy won't work. Now, I know why we do it, because what's the alternative? How do we offer the Sunnis, a reasonable place to be if they don't have some support from Baghdad? But I think we need to start thinking about it. I think we need to put a lot of pressure on our Gulf allies, like Saudi Arabia, like the UAE, to say, look, these are your people. The Baghdad government has abandoned them. You don't want ISIS to be the alternative. What can you do to encourage the tribes in Syria and Iraq to turn on ISIS? It's not easy. And again, I'll just close by saying, we could drop 200,000 U.S. troops in the middle of this. It wouldn't solve the problem. And I sincerely hope we've learned that lesson, and then we don't go deeper and deeper into that, costing more lives and more treasure while only making the problem worse. Because the bottom line is, for all of their faults and failings, the one dependable argument that groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS have with the Muslim world is to stand up and say, we are defending the Muslim world against Western aggression. That is a message that has widespread support, far more support, certainly, than the violent psychopathic groups that espouse it. We cannot contribute to that. We've got to find a way to build partnerships. This has to be locally driven by Sunnis in Iraq, in Syria, and elsewhere, to eject ISIS, to eject that ideology, and build a better future for their people. And that is no easy task, I understand. But I do look forward to the testimony and the questions, and hopefully we can learn more about how to go about being part of that solution. With that, I yield back.
Thank you. Without objection, your complete written statements will be made part of the record. Again, thank you both for being here. Ms. Secretary, the floor is yours.
Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Smith, all members of the committee, thank you for inviting me here today. Thank you also for keeping a wide-ranging and long-term perspective on the challenges and opportunities for America and its leadership around the world. Just a couple of weeks ago, I was in Singapore, Vietnam, and India, and next week I'll be in Germany, Estonia, and Belgium for a NATO ministerial. I understand that your focus in this hearing is current developments in the Middle East. I'd be happy to answer questions about anything else. The Middle East, as the chairman noted, is undergoing a period of great social and political turmoil with a number and variety of cross-cutting geopolitical developments. Our strategy in the region, America's strategy, is grounded in America's core national interests. That's the foundation. Tailored to address specific circumstances in specific and various places, Iraq, Syria, Iran, and so forth. And it leverages American leadership with the efforts of a coalition of allies and partners. Our core interests, for example, drive our actions to prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon. Similarly, they dictate that we not let up until we have destroyed ISIL and al-Qaeda-affiliated terrorists throughout the region that pose dangers to...
The chair knows there's a disturbance in the committee's proceedings. The committee will be in order. Pardon the interruption, Mr. Secretary. Please proceed.
Similarly, our core interests dictate that we not let up until we have destroyed ISIL and al-Qaeda-affiliated terrorists throughout the region that pose dangers to the homeland, to friends, and to allies. The past few weeks serve as a reminder to terrorists bent on harming the United States and our interests, whether they're in Libya, Syria, or Yemen, that we have the capability to reach out and strike them. Meanwhile, the security of Israel will always be one of my top priorities. And the chairman just returned from Israel this past weekend. And we'll continue to hone important security relationships with our partners in the Gulf, bolster their security, and ensure freedom of navigation there. The pursuit of our nation's core interests in the region is a strategy based on tireless diplomacy, backed by formidable military power and dedicated capacity building to buttress and leverage the contributions of others, and especially, as noted, those in the region themselves. That's why we have 35,000 forces postured throughout the region, enabling us to strike ISIL and al-Qaeda terrorists and check Iranian malign influence. That's why we're assuring Israel's continued qualitative military edge, and why we're working with our Gulf partners to make them more capable of defending themselves against external aggression. That's why we're supporting Saudi Arabia in protecting its territory and people from Houthi attacks, and supporting international efforts to prevent Iranian shipments of lethal equipment from reaching Houthi and Saleh-affiliated forces in Yemen. And that's why the United States is supporting efforts to pursue political settlements to crises throughout the region, from Yemen to Libya to Syria. While I'm prepared for a range of questions related to DOD's role in the Middle East, I'd like to focus on the immediate issue that I understand the committee is interested in, namely the U.S.-led coalition's strategy to defeat ISIL. ISIL presents a grave threat to our friends and allies in the Middle East, elsewhere around the world, from Africa and Europe to parts of Asia, because of its steady metastasis, and to our homeland, because of its avowed intentions to strike and recruit in this country. ISIL must be and will be dealt a lasting defeat. The strategy to degrade and ultimately defeat ISIL, constructed by President Obama, draws upon all the national security agencies of the U.S. government, intelligence, law enforcement, diplomacy, and others. The strategy and its associated military campaign also involve a global coalition, reflecting both the worldwide consensus on the need to counter this threat and the practical requirement for others to do their part. And the counter-ISIL strategy has nine so-called lines of effort, reflecting the breadth of this challenge and the tools needed to combat it. The first and most critical line of effort is the political one, which is led by the State Department. In Iraq, this involves building more effective, inclusive, and multi-sectarian governance. Each of the other lines of effort requires success in this line because it's the only way to create support among local forces and local people, that support being necessary to make progress against extremism stick. The next two lines of effort are interconnected: to deny ISIL safe haven and to build partnership capacity in Iraq and Syria. Both are led by the Department of Defense, which, alongside coalition partners, is conducting a bombing campaign from the air, advising and assisting Iraqi security forces on the ground, and training and equipping trusted local forces. I will address our military's current execution of these two lines of effort in a moment, but I want to underscore a crucial point about our campaign in Iraq and also Syria. It requires capable, motivated, legitimate local ground forces to seize, clear, and hold terrain. That's the only way to ensure a truly lasting, enduring defeat of this movement. The fourth line of effort is enhancing intelligence collection on ISIL, which is led by the National Counterterrorism Center. The fifth line of effort, which is disrupting ISIL's finances, a vital task, is co-led by Treasury and State. Lines of effort 6 and 7, both co-led by State and the National Counterterrorism Center, are to counter ISIL's messaging and to disrupt the flow of foreign fighters to and from ISIL, both of which are critical in today's connected and networked world. The eighth line of effort, providing humanitarian support to those displaced by or vulnerable to ISIL, is led by State. And finally, the Department of Homeland Security and the FBI are working together to protect the homeland, the ninth so-called line of effort, by disrupting terrorist threats here. The effective execution of all nine of these lines of effort by the United States and its coalition partners is plainly necessary to ensure overall success. Let me turn to the execution of DOD's two lines of effort, beginning with the U.S.-led campaign of airstrikes against ISIL in Iraq and Syria. This effort has produced some clear results in limiting ISIL's freedom of movement, constraining its ability to reinforce its fighters, and impeding its command and control. It has enabled some key achievements for local forces, including the very recent success of anti-ISIL forces who took the key town of Tal Abyad. The strikes are also buying critical time and space to carry out DOD's second line of effort, which is developing the capacity and capabilities of legitimate local forces. The ground campaign is a work in progress. The Iraqi security forces were severely degraded after Mosul fell last June, when four divisions dissolved. The combination of disunity, deserters, and so-called ghost soldiers, who are paid on the books but don't show up or don't exist, had greatly diminished their capacity. However, understanding these challenges does not change reality. ISIL's lasting defeat still requires local forces to fight and prevail on the ground. We can and will continue to develop and enable such local forces because we know from experience that putting U.S. combat troops on the ground as a substitute for local forces will not produce enduring results. That's why DOD seeks to bolster Iraq's security forces to be capable of winning back and then defending and holding the ISIL-controlled portions of the Iraqi state. What we saw in Ramadi last month was deeply disappointing and illustrated the importance of a capable and motivated Iraqi ground force. In the days that followed, all of us on the President's national security team, at his direction, took another hard look at our campaign across all nine lines of effort. At DOD, I convened my team before, during, and after my trip to the Asia Pacific and Indian Ocean region to examine our execution of DOD's lines of effort and prepare options for the President if his approval was required for any enhancements we identified. In our meetings at both the White House and the Pentagon, we determined that while we have the right strategic framework, execution of the campaign can and should be strengthened, especially on the ground. We determined that our training efforts could be enhanced and thus are now focusing on increasing participation in and throughput of our training efforts, working closely with the Iraqi government and stressing the focus on drawing in Sunni forces, which, as noted, are underrepresented in the Iraqi security forces today. We also determined that our equipping of the Iraqi security forces had proceeded too slowly. This process was earlier, sometimes delayed by bureaucracy in Baghdad, but also in Washington. That's why we're now expediting delivery of essential equipment and material like anti-tank capabilities and counter-IED equipment to the Iraqi security forces, including Kurdish and Sunni tribal forces. We also determined that we could enable Iraqi security forces with more tailored advice and assistance, including with critical outreach to Sunni communities. That's why, on advice from Chairman Dempsey and General Austin, and at my recommendation, last week President Obama authorized the deployment of 450 personnel to Iraq's Takata military base in Anbar province to establish an additional site where we could advise and assist the Iraqi security forces. Situated between Ramadi and Fallujah, Takadum is a key location for engaging Sunni tribes. And Prime Minister Abadi, Iraqi military officials, and Sunni leaders have all committed to using Takadum to reinvigorate and expedite the recruitment of Sunni fighters. Our forces will also provide much-needed operational advice and planning support to the Iraqi Security Forces Anbar Operations Center, which is also located at Takadum. We expect that this move will open a new dimension in our and Iraq's efforts to recruit Sunnis into the fight and to help the Iraqis coordinate and plan the critical effort to roll back ISIL in Anbar province. And Secretary Kerry and I have agreed to begin a process of continually assessing the execution of our campaign, starting with improving coordination across our respective lines of effort. Execution, however, is a two-way street, and our training efforts in Iraq have thus far been slowed by a lack of trainees. We simply haven't received enough recruits. Of the 24,000 Iraqi security forces we had originally envisioned training at our four sites by this fall, we've only received enough recruits to be able to train about 7,000, in addition to 2,000 counterterrorism service personnel. As I've told Iraqi leaders, while the United States is open to supporting Iraq more than we already are, we must see a greater commitment from all parts of the Iraqi government. There are positive signs. I've met with Prime Minister Abadi, Iraqi Kurdistan Regional President Barzani, and just last week with Speaker Jaburi of Iraq's parliament. They all fully understand the need to empower more localized, multi-sectarian Iraqi security forces and address persistent organization and leadership failures. And because a sovereign, multi-sectarian Iraq is more likely to ensure a lasting defeat of ISIL, the United States must continue working with and through the Iraqi government in all our actions, including our support for Kurdish and Sunni tribal forces. Our efforts need to reinforce inclusivity and multi-sectarianism, not fuel a reversal to sectarianism, which would make the lasting defeat of ISIL harder, not easier. The situation in Syria is even more complex because of the lack of a legitimate government partner and many competing forces there. Regardless, we will continue striking ISIL in Syria with the long reach of our airstrikes and operators. We will continue working with Syria's neighbors to impede the flow of foreign fighters into and out of Syria and Iraq. Our train and equip mission in Syria has been challenging, but the requirement for a capable and motivated counter-ISIL ground force there also means we must persist in our efforts. In conclusion, I believe that success in this campaign can and must be assured. It will take time and require consistent effort on everyone's part, the entire U.S. government, our entire international coalition, and most importantly, the Iraqi and Syrian peoples. Together and with your support, including your support for America's troops and their families, for which I and they are ever grateful, we will achieve ISIL's lasting defeat. Be happy to address your questions.
Thank you. General Dempsey, you have already had a number of interactions with this committee in the first 6 months of this year, for which we are very grateful. And that's the reason, as I told you before the hearing, I'm not going to say goodbye to you, even though the date of your retirement approaches. So thank you for being here. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman. It is good to be back, in particular to talk about a subject of this importance. And Ranking Member Smith, it's good to see you back in the fight. Personally, I know you've been in the fight from a distance. And other members of the committee, I really do appreciate the opportunity to be here this morning to discuss the increasing disorder and the military component of our strategy in the Middle East. The Middle East is unpredictable, unstable, and increasingly complex, but our goals are quite straightforward. We seek a region that is inhospitable to our enemies and that promotes and protects our core national interests. I characterize the current environment in the Middle East in terms of three converging sets of complexity. First, several governments are struggling for political legitimacy because they are not sufficiently pluralistic or they are not sufficiently accountable to their citizens. Iraq, for example, is still working toward a national unity government. Second, the centuries-old Sunni-Shia rivalry has come to the fore. Weak states are less able to assert independence amid the tug of war between sectarian regional powers. And third, internal to Islam, we see rising competition between moderate elements and radical elements, and into that space fits ISIL and others. These three challenges, as they intersect, make for an environment that will test the resolve of the region's security forces. Enduring stability cannot be imposed from the outside in. Stability must be cultivated from the inside out, and importantly, owned by regional stakeholders. Positive transformation of the region will be achieved over time by, with, and through our regional partners. Within this context, the role of the United States military is taking against the trans-regional threat of ISIL represents, in my judgment, an appropriate level of effort. I'd underscore, as Secretary Carter also emphasized, that the military is one component of a much broader strategy. Military power alone will not solve this. I don't think anyone in here would disagree with that. We own two lines of effort of nine. Our two lines of effort, one is kinetic, the combination of airstrikes and ISR to enable Iraqi security forces, and the other, which is actually the centerpiece of our military strategy, is the train and equip mission. The nine lines of effort should be considered in the aggregate. This campaign focuses on building partners who are taking responsibility for their own security. As I've said before, this is an Iraq-first strategy enabled by the coalition, but not an Iraq-only one, and again, certainly not a military-only one. We continue to pressure ISIL in Syria and to actively reinforce and harden our partners in the region. I'd also like to emphasize that we are at the beginning of a complex, nonlinear campaign that will require a sustained level of effort over an extended period of time to promote durable regional stability over the long term. We are constantly evaluating our approach and making sure we're resourcing it appropriately, balanced with our many other global commitments. Let me again thank this committee for what you do every day to support our men and women in uniform and their families who are serving around the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Secretary, let me just follow up on what General Dempsey said. A primary line of effort of the department is this train and equip mission. Is it your judgment that 450 more folks, not all of whom will be trainers, some are security and so forth, but are these 450 more folks going to tip the balance to make that train and equip mission successful?
The move into Qatim, the numbers are not as significant as the location. It's in the heart of Sunni territory, and I think it will make a big difference in the performance of the train and equip program as regards recruiting Sunni fighters. We're actually seeing that in the days since we established that presence there. Also, the Anbar Operations Center of the Iraqi Security Forces is located at Al-Taqadim, and another function of those people being there, doesn't take a lot of people, but is highly leveraged, is to be in the Anbar Operations Center with the Iraqi forces so that we can help them with their command and control planning and discipline. So those are the purposes, those are the benefits of the move to Qatim. It is necessary, it's not sufficient, but it's necessary to get Sunni forces into the fight in a way so that they are motivated as well as trained and equipped, and that's its purpose, Mr. Chairman.
So what's the reasonable time period for us to check back and see whether this is working as we hope?
I honestly think it's reasonable for you to ask in weeks, because we're already getting an inflow of Sunni fighters. We'll put them through the training program. We have the capacity to do that. As I mentioned in my testimony, we have had unused capacity in our train and equip sites in parts of Iraq over the last several months because the Iraqi government hasn't furnished us with paid recruits. Now that is turning around. It has to stay turned around for us to have success in Anbar and elsewhere in Sunni parts of Iraq.
Let me ask one other question. As you mentioned, I think a lot of members will have questions about the ISIS fight. I want to ask about the strategy to deal with Iranian influence outside the nuclear talks. So we'll set the nuclear talks for aside. I mentioned in my opening statement these press reports about the Iranians equipping and paying the Taliban who are fighting us and our allies in Afghanistan. We know that they are providing tremendous support to the Houthis in the civil war, or whatever one wants to call it, that's going on in Yemen. They are the primary force propping up Assad in Syria. They continue to have a presence in Lebanon, which is not good. What is the administration's strategy for dealing with Iranian influence other than the nuclear talks?
Thank you. And Iranian malign influence in the region is the other major challenge to our strategy in the Middle East besides ISIL. So those two stand above others. And I think I would go back to the foundation there, which is the checking that malign influence and defending our ally Israel and our keeping our security commitments to our Gulf partners who were here in town a few weeks ago is the reason why there are 35,000 U.S. forces based in the Middle East. It's to provide that foundation of security for our friends and allies and to check Iranian malign influence, which, as you indicated, one sees them seeking Iraq, we've just been talking about, but it's not just in Iraq. It's elsewhere around the region. So it is another very significant challenge for us, and it really is the reason why we are postured in the way we are in the Middle East. The chairman just got back from Israel, by the way, and he's been working with our Israeli partners on exactly those kinds of checks.
Well, I appreciate the fact we've got folks over there. I still haven't heard quite an approach because it seems to me like their influence is expanding, and I'm not sure we're dealing with it. I'll yield to Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The chairman and I met last week with the Sunni leader of the Iraqi parliament, and one of the things he said during our meeting that surprised me a little bit as we were talking about, you know, the difficulty of getting broader support from the Baghdad government and sort of shifting focus to where could the Sunnis in that path between sort of Anbar and up into Syria, where ISIL is, most dominant. And he expressed disappointment, frankly, that the other Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, UAE, or even Turkey to go up north, did not seem to really be willing to provide much support, even Jordan as well, for the Sunnis in that area. Number one is, do you agree with that assessment? I tend to take this guy at his word. And number two, why? It would seem to me that, you know, defeating ISIL is something that would be very, very important to Saudi Arabia amongst the others there. Why aren't they doing more to help those groups that want to resist ISIS in that part of Iraq and Syria?
That's a critical question, and it goes back to something you said in your opening statement about other Sunni and Arab forces countering ISIL. And I, too, met with Mr. Jabouri last week, who said the same thing. And I think he was speaking on behalf of a number of the Sunni forces, political forces in Western Iraq, who would like to see more support and recognize, as I think you noted and the chairman noted in their opening statement, that Americans and Westerners are can lead and enable, but if they get too high a profile, that becomes a problem in its own right.
Exactly.
Therefore, all the more reason to get others involved, Sunnis involved in the fight. Now, the heads of, one thing I'll note is the heads of state of the GCC were here in Washington, and we went to Camp David about 3 weeks ago. And I would say that this was one of the major themes of our conversations with them. The other one being, to get to back to what the chairman said, checking Iranian malign influence, which they're also concerned about. Their concern about ISIL is genuine, but their actions, I think, can be greatly strengthened. And that was one of the principal things we talked about, getting them in the train and equip program.
Again, yeah, sorry? Yeah, I got all that, but why? Why isn't, I mean, what in your opinion, having worked with these people, why isn't it happening?
Well, one reason is that they simply lack the capacity. And so we talked a lot about building special operations forces that had counter, as opposed to air forces. We have enough air forces. Okay. We're looking for ground forces. And capable ground forces is one that are skilled in counterterrorism, counterinsurgency, and so forth.
And that's, that's one of the key questions. Sorry to interrupt. But that's where we've got to go. And that's where, you know, we've got this fight. We had this fight in the Senate and also on the House side over whether or not to directly arm the Kurds, to basically skip the Baghdad government and just get the forces, the people who are actually fighting, and in some cases fighting successfully. You know, shouldn't we be shifting a lot of our focus to that and basically saying to Baghdad, time's up. You know, you've got your relationship with Iran, with the Shia militias. Doesn't seem to be much we can do about that. You continually push the Sunnis out. We got to shift our resources to people. I mean, you mentioned it. We expected 24,000 Iraqis. You got 7,000. I mean, at what point do we shift the strategy? And I understand the implications of that. You know, the concern is about the fracturing of Iraq. But as I have said many times before, that cow has left the barn. Iraq is fractured. You can make a pretty powerful argument, in fact, that Iraq is no more. So when do we shift that strategy and start building the capabilities of other partners who will fight?
Well, sectarianism in Iraq is the principal factor that brought us to where Iraq is in ISIL. It was Prime Minister Maliki and his relentlessly partisan or sectarian manner of governance. Now, we have in the Prime Minister Abadi, with whom I've met, and the chairman may have met also, but certainly mentioned, someone who I believe is genuinely committed to behaving in a decentralized, federalized, if you like, but multi-sectarian single state. Personally, he's dedicated to that.
Yes.
I think the chairman asked the question, does his writ run throughout Iraq? And that's what we are waiting to see. In the meantime, we are arming the Kurds. We are arming the Sunnis. We do it in coordination with the Iraqi government, but in a way that doesn't delay, as it was a few months ago, that assistance to them. But we're still doing it through the government of Iraq because we're still trying to support the Prime Minister in maintaining a decentralized but single unitary Iraqi state.
And just a quick thing on Iran. And obviously, I mean, if we just had these extremist Sunni groups to fight, I mean, that would be enough to really challenge us. But then when you throw in Iranian influence and how it stirs up the region, it definitely creates a higher level problem. But I do just want to make the observation, as awful as Iran is, number one, this isn't really necessarily helping them to have to fight multiple wars outside of their own borders, to have to fight in Syria, to fight in Iraq, to fight in Yemen. That can be draining, as we well know. So there's a negative influence on them as well. And whatever one may say about Iran, the difference between them and ISIL, ISIL wants to kill, they wake up every morning, anxious to kill as many Americans as possible. So as we're balancing this, it's a very difficult balance to make. Defeating ISIL, I think, should be at the top of that list of concerns. That's just an observation. As bad as Iran is, and trying to figure out some way to get them to stop having that malign influence, all for it. But I think we really need to have our number one focus, not just, again, on ISIL, but on that brighter ideology that motivates people to attack us. Final quick question. There have been some reports that, the Assad government is weakening. Where do you assess the chances that they might just fall? That Assad might, he is unable to replace many of the troops that he's losing now. Is it possible that Assad just up and leaves because of how bad things are going? And then what?
Two observations on that, and then the chairman may want to comment on that as well. First of all, we would like to see a transition in which Assad disappeared from the scene so that his regime as another source of fuel for extremism is eliminated. That is, it is possible because his forces are much weakened. And they have taken great losses. They're having trouble. Their forces and their reserves are depleted, they are increasingly isolated in the Damascus area and in the Alawite areas of northwestern Syria. I think the last thing I'd say. Congressman Smith, is that the best way for the Syrian people for this to go would be for him to remove himself from the scene, and there to be created, difficult as that will be, a new government of Syria based on the moderate opposition that we have been trying to build and support, and then helping them strengthen themselves and to retake all of Syrian territory. That would be a desirable path if he did was removed from the scene or removed himself from the scene.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ranking Member Smith. That was the purpose of my trip to the region, actually, was to discuss with regional partners a scenario in which the regime would either collapse or Assad would depart for one reason or another. And it's generally the consensus there that in the near term, it's probably more likely that the regime would go over to the defensive and limit its protection of the Alawite, Shia, and some of the minority groups, leaving the rest of Syria essentially ungoverned or governed in ways that wouldn't be positive for the region in the near term. And so we're working with our partners on the near term.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Forbes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, the country owes you a great deal of gratitude, but I only have 5 minutes, so I'm just going to say thank you for all that you've done for us. And Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here today. We're talking about policy and strategy in the Middle East. And one thing that I find a little disconcerting from people I talk to is when we find individuals who have held your job in the past as Secretary of Defense who indicate, rightly or wrongly, that the President's heart may not always be in some of our military operations. It's also disconcerting when we hear the President, rightly or wrongly, suggest that we may have no winning strategy in the Middle East. But it's also disconcerting as a committee, we're not always in the policy and strategy business. but we're in the resourcing and capability business here. And we look at just some of the gaps we have. We know that we're going to have a gap this year for our carriers, where we will have certain regions of the world that will not have a carrier presence for weeks when we perhaps need one or two. We also know that in 2007, the Navy was able to meet 90% of our COCOM validated requirements. This year, we'll only meet 44%. We've had testimony from the Air Force that they currently have the oldest and the smallest Air Force since the history of the Air Force, and that less than 50% of their combat squadrons are fully combat capable. So this committee, on a very bipartisan basis, has worked very, very hard to try to close some of those gaps, to reach some of the numbers that you need. We voted out an NDAA bill, 269 to 151. This committee voted it out 60 to 2. We have passed a defense appropriations bill, 278 to 149. By all likelihood, it looks like a conference report will come out, and those bills will be before the President in September of this year. You probably know we have 12 appropriations bills. The first one up before the President will probably be the defense bills, and the President will have 11 days to sign them. Now, you were kind enough, on an unsolicited basis the last time you were here, to suggest to us what your recommendation would be to the President about vetoing bills. Now that you actually have a real bill to look at and to analyze, which helps fill some of those gaps, can you tell us whether or not you would recommend that the President veto that bill if it's substantially the same bill that has passed on a bipartisan basis out of the House, both on the NDAA and the appropriations bill?
Thank you, Congressman. And let me just second what you said about the chairman. He's been my battle buddy now for a number of years, as I had various jobs, and he was chairman before that, chief of staff of the Army, and I'm very much going to miss him. It's been terrific. You're absolutely right about resources. We cannot continue to be the world's finest fighting force if we don't get a budget a budget picture and horizon in front of us. I haven't changed my view from last time I saw you. I really fervently hope, and this isn't something I'm skilled in and I won't be part of the deliberations within the Congress, but I fervently hope that everybody can come together, both parties.
Mr. Secretary, I don't want to cut you off. I just have a minute and some left. Here's my point. We don't always get to pick the bills we hope that we can have. I'm saying if a bill comes substantially the same as the NDAA bill and the Defense Appropriations bill that passed the House, would you recommend to the President that he sign that bill or that he veto that bill?
The President's already said that he's going to veto the bill.
No, I'm asking your recommendation because you gave us a recommendation.
I support that.
So you would recommend that he veto those bills?
He has already determined that he's going to
veto
those bills.
But you would recommend that?
I want.
Now, let me ask you this. Have you done an analysis of the risk that would put to national defense? Because the result of that would be that you'd get at least $25 billion less.
Let me describe the risk that going 1 year at a time in budgeting.
No, I'm just asking the difference between.
I know what you're asking, but I would like
to. So you're not prepared to ask that?
A sort of herky-jerky approach to our budget is. It's managerially harmful to do things.
Well, Mr. Secretary, you will have $25 billion short if that bill fails, but you would still take that risk. And by the way, that risk would put us, according to General Dempsey, at a place where we would be below the minimum edge of what we need for our national security. And let me just end up, Mr. Chairman, by saying this. I think it is unimaginable that we would send 450 troops into harm's way and still look their families in the eye and tell them and their families we'd veto a bill that would get them the resources they need. And with that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Time, gentlemen, has expired. Ms. Davis.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to reiterate that I haven't changed my view. We need a multi-year defense budget. We have a strategy that we don't, that is a long-term strategy. We have people, the very people that Congressman Forbes just referred to, who have careers, who want to know what their future is going to be. And this business where we have a budget 1 year at a time, And I'm not blaming anybody for it. I realize it's a collective thing where our country needs to rise up and get it together in this area. I'm just telling you, it's very damaging to the institution that I feel responsible for and am responsible for. And the other thing I'd say is I travel around the world, and this is this looks terrible. It gives the appearance that we are diminishing ourselves because we can't come together behind a budget year in and year out. And so I continue to hope and believe that we can come together behind an agreed budget that has a multi-year horizon and allows us to plan and execute programs and recruit and retain people in the way that I think we need to do. Thank you.
Mr. Secretary, I don't disagree with anything you just said. When we vote, it's yes or no. And I think that's the point on the veto. It's a yes or no. And so that's the thing that I think is concerning to me. Ms. Davis.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you both for being here. And of course, General Dempsey, I greatly appreciate your service and all you've contributed. And I think, you know, there's obviously controversy and concern about your response. I appreciate the fact that it is a direct response and that we'd like everyone actually to get to yes on this one. And we have to work harder on it. So thank you very much. I wanted to first just ask about what you talked about as the first critical line of effort really here, which, as you say, is a political one. And my concern is that with limited security that we have, I'm not sure that the State Department, even if they had the resources, and I think we could, you know, that's obviously a very great concern, if they're really able to do their job in Iraq. So I'd like you to respond to that. And along with that really does go the fourth line, which is how we communicate and whether we're doing that effectively. Those are two important things. And the third thing I just wanted to ask you about briefly is, you know, the issue about resources. And you mentioned the fact that we need to expedite delivery of equipment, that we weren't doing a good job with that. I think my question is, why did that take so long? There are issues around certainly Baghdad, as you mentioned, but within our own policies as well. What are we learning from that so that that really doesn't happen in the future? Thank you, sir. Thank you, General.
Thank you. On the political front, which really means trying to support Prime Minister Abadi and the government of Iraq to govern in a way that it can collect in support from Sunnis, collect in support from Kurds, and collect in support from Shiites who are not affiliated with or directly supported by Iran, and create an Iraqi security force that can defeat ISIL and turn Iraq into a place where people can live in a decent way. That is an essential task, and we need to align that very closely with the military line, which is why I mentioned that Secretary Kerry, who's just come back into town, and I are meeting, and our teams are meeting specifically to make sure that those lines of effort, our two and his, are synchronized. Messaging. I'd only make one note about messaging, which is an area where I think we are unnecessarily hobbling ourselves. We, for example, had a website, CENTCOM had a website, which simply described the facts of our campaign and what was going on. It was tuned for an audience in the region so that they could come to a website and learn about what we were doing. So we're telling the truth, but we were denied the authority to operate that. And told that that was not an appropriate thing for the Department of Defense to be doing. I'd like to be able to have that authority with respect to.
And sir, I'm sorry, denied the authority from.
By Congress.
It
with respect to training and equipping, this is one of these situations where there's plenty of responsibility to pass around, and I wouldn't put it all on the Iraqis, and I wouldn't put it all on us, and I wouldn't put it all on Congress and all on the Pentagon. But let me just tell you what happened. Since you passed the money for 2015, the appropriations bill in December, The money came out in January, went through whatever OMB processed, and then there was in your bill the requirement that we only spend 25% of it until we report on the last 75%. We met that requirement. That really, I can't say, was the limiting step. The limiting step for us to expend that money was building the training sites. What we did do in the meantime while we were waiting for that money is reach into all kinds of other pots we have, excess defense articles and so forth. And so we tried to fill the gap. Now the gap's closed now and that money is flowing. But it wasn't all on the Iraqi side, although they were an impediment, particularly when it came to arming Sunnis mm-hmm. and Kurds. The government in Baghdad didn't want us to do that. But anyway, we're back on our feet now, but I'm not going to try to excuse something that took longer than it should have.
Thank you. And just quickly, with the 2 seconds left I have on the resources that the Secretary Kerry and the State Department are going to have and the backup security, I just want to be sure that we get a full answer on that. Thank you.
I'd be happy to provide that.
Ms. Secretary, both Mr. Smith and I'd be very interested to know or to have you follow up who denied CENTCOM the ability to put up a website with the facts and on what basis they denied it. He and I have worked for some years to update some of the outdated restrictions on these sorts of issues, and we are very interested in fixing this problem if part of the problem is with this branch of government.
Thank you.
So if you'd ask your lawyers to do that,
absolutely.
It's very
important. Thank you
very much. Chairman Klein.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here today. I was looking at the preparation sheet here for today's hearing, and it says, this is a reference, quote, United States policy and strategy in the Middle East. And I think we've concluded that we don't have a strategy. In fact, the Commander-in-Chief said we didn't really have a strategy. So I'm a little bit mystified about exactly what we're doing here since we don't have a strategy. And I'm looking at the situation in Iraq. I was over there just in Baghdad a couple of months ago around Easter time frame and talking to some of our troops there. We've got over 3,000 troops on the ground, boots on the ground. They're a little frustrated because I don't think they understand, and how could they, what the strategy is if we haven't clearly articulated that. Now we're going to send 450 more people over there, and again, to execute a strategy that we don't know yet. So as I look at Iraq and his, you know, Chairman Dempsey, I, like a lot of members here, have been there over and over and over again, and I've watched the situation change. And it was at one point where we looked like we were doing really well after the surge, and then we saw ISIS or ISIL or Daesh come pouring across the border and cities start to fall and Baghdad reportedly being threatened. And so I guess my question is where are we in Iraq today? Are we winning? Are we losing? Is it a stalemate? Is it a quagmire? What is Iraq today? Either one. Yes, sir. General, we'll start with you.
I never volunteer. I mean,
I'm helping you.
You call on me, I'll answer. But
I'm helping you, General.
You're up. I've been in the Army for a long time. You don't volunteer for things.
We volunteer in the Marines all the time.
Yeah, I know.
Hard for me to understand.
And then you
that.
Call the Army to actually do the logistics for you. I got it.
Yeah, we'll fight to the last soldier. So.
Now, where were we? Where are we?
Are we in a quagmire there? Is it a stalemate? Are we winning? What's going on?
I got it. And by the way, so let's talk about the personal pronoun we. This has to be them, right? So if you're asking, is the United States winning, that's the wrong question.
No, I'm sorry. That's the question I'm asking.
Well,
we've got soldiers there. We've got a commitment
sure.
there. We're flying strikes there. Are we, the United States, free world, Western allies, our allies there, are we winning or losing?
The United States military's campaign in support of a 60-nation coalition and the Iraqi government, we are on path to deliver that which we've committed to delivering, which is security forces, not just the ISF, but also the Peshmerga and now the Sunni tribes. We are on path to deliver to them the capability to confront ISIL inside of their sovereign territory. This is a far different approach than if we were to decide ourselves that it was our responsibility to defeat ISIL inside of Iraq. As the Secretary said, it's my military judgment that an enduring victory over ISIL can only be accomplished by those nations and stakeholders in the region who have as much and actually more to gain or lose than we do.
So, so I guess that does that, that wouldn't put it stalemate, that doesn't make it quagmire, that makes it sort of winning, or?
No, here's what it makes. You've famously heard Stan McChrystal, when he was still on active duty, talk about confronting al-Qaeda. And he talked about the fact that al-Qaeda is a network, and that to defeat a network, we have to be a network. And Stan went off and built a very exquisite network of allies and partners to confront al-Qaeda. That's what we're trying to do against ISIL in Iraq. I used the lily pad example on why we're going to Takadum. Now, most of you probably know that on the surface, literally, it looks as though lily pads are free-floating, but they're not. They're tethered to a network of vegetation underneath. They are a network. We're trying to build a network that will enable the regional stakeholders to confront this threat, because frankly, that's the only way it will be resolved.
Okay, I'll accept that answer, except it underscores where we started this thing. We really don't have a strategy. You've articulated a piece of what would be sort of a strategy. A strategy is to build a network that's not exactly clear what that is. I think we need a clearly articulated strategy of what we, the United States, are going to do in cooperation with, in alliance with, or whatever that's going to be, friends and allies. When I was over there, the Arab states are now increasingly engaged. As you know, they're flying strikes there, but we also hear reports that strikes are going without success in many cases, without even bombs being dropped. We got some work to do there, and I think we ought to start with that strategy. I yield back.
Mr. Langevin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you, Mr. Secretary, and Mr. Chairman, thank you for your testimony, and both of you for your service. And Mr. Chairman, especially with you, obviously with all the expertise and experience that you'll take with you when that time comes, you'll leave very big shoes to fill. And I, again, want to thank you for all you've accomplished and for all your service. Mr. Secretary, can you convince me and the American people that our strategy in Iraq right now in trying to hold that country together is the right one, given the fact that it doesn't seem like the Iraqi people are willing to fight for their own country, evidenced by the fact that the soldiers that that we helped to train when ISIL came in, they basically took the uniforms off and ran. And it doesn't seem to me that and you mentioned the sectarian violence and the sectarianism that exists. Are we trying to artificially hold together an Iraq that doesn't want to be held together? And are we asking our men and women in uniform to go into a situation and put themselves in harm's way for an artificial effort to hold that country together? Would we be better off focusing on another strategy that had a more realistic look at what the local people there want, and pursue a strategy that will then allow us to focus on, once and for all, defeating ISIL. Beyond that, with the President's decision last week to send 450 additional advisors to Iraq, I'd like to know how this outwardly reactive move is coupled to a strategy and how it addresses bottlenecks in terms of the results that we'd like to see from our efforts and those of our allies and partners. And the ranking member mentioned how the leader of the Iraqi parliament was disappointed that we don't have more buy-in from nations in the region. I want to ensure that, as I'm sure my colleagues here do as well, that we aren't asking our men and women in uniform to risk their lives for actions that are disconnected from a larger strategic effort. So,
thank you, Congressman. And some of the parts of your question echo the questions that Mr. Klein was putting. I mean, we'll start with one thing, which is I can't thank him, but we very much appreciate it when you do visit our people. And it's important that they have an explanation of what our strategy is, even as it's important that you, as our oversight committee, have an explanation of what our strategy is. And with respect to Iraq, the critical ingredient of the strategy is strengthening local forces. We believe that is possible. It'll take some time, and the American role in that is to train, equip, enable, and assist those forces once they're built. And that's not, and that is the American role in a coalition. So that's the approach to defeating ISIL on the ground in Iraq, recognizing that only their defeat on the ground can be a lasting defeat, a sustained defeat. And so that is the approach we are taking on the ground in Iraq and Syria. As we discussed earlier, there are other parts of the counter-ISIL strategy that are also very vital. They don't happen to be our responsibility. But on the intelligence side, which is very challenging with this group, on the counter-messaging side, finances, foreign fighter flows, these guys who come in and potentially come out, including to this country. So there are a lot of different dimensions to combating this danger. But the strategy on the ground in Iraq is as I described and as the chairman described.
Are we trying to unofficially hold together an Iraq that doesn't want to be held together?
I believe that there are some indications that there can be a decentralized but multi-sectarian unitary Iraq. That is the path that Prime Minister Abadi says he's on, that other leaders like Mr. Jaburi, who was here last week, says he's on. I think we ought to give them a chance because that's the best outcome. Sectarianism is not a good outcome there. We've been to that movie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Time and gentleman's expired. Mr. Lamborn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you both for your service and what you're doing to protect our country. But I have a question building on some previous questions about why we are not targeting known ISIS assets. For instance, everyone knows where the headquarters of ISIS is in Raqqa, Syria, I believe, a large multi-story building. We know that there are convoys of oil, crude oil, being taken to Turkey, sold to raise money for ISIS. That's a kind of a lifeline for money, as far as I look at it. So, I can't imagine that it's a military decision to not take out known military assets. So there must be a political reason. So, Mr. Carter, what is the political reason, or why are we not targeting known ISIS assets, if the intention is to degrade and destroy ISIS, as the president has said?
Congressman, the target types that you described are authorized. Leadership targets, indeed. Fuel, which is partly used to finance this movement, legitimate target. We do strike those targets. I think the only limitation, and I'll let the chairman elaborate on this, that the people managing the coalition air campaign have, and this is a coalition judgment, not just a U.S. judgment, is to try to avoid civilian casualties. And that is for obvious humanitarian reasons, and also because it's not going to help what we're ultimately trying to do, which is get ISIL expelled.
So no targets are you're saying no targets are hands off.
No, the categories you named are absolutely hands on, and we have struck targets like we need to strike targets like that. So that's definitely part of the air campaign. Let me ask the chairman anything to add.
I'll tell you, sir, the Commander CENTCOM, who holds the authority for strike decisions and the establishment of collateral damage estimates within the ROE, he has the authority. Nothing that happens in Washington, D.C. is limiting him from the use of the, by the way, 397 strike aircraft and 1,600 pilots who are flying these missions over Iraq and Syria every day. It's really a matter of ensuring that the targets we hit are the targets we intend, because to do otherwise would actually further complicate this and make it an almost impossible situation to sort out.
Okay. And if I can switch gears to Iran, they come into our discussion. I know it's the Middle East we're talking about, but Iran is part of this. Recently, Ali Heenan of the IAEA spoke to some congressmen and said, and he knows more about Iran and nuclear negotiations than anyone in the world. He said you have to have two things for a deal to work, or Iran will get a nuclear weapon, that there be able to be unannounced inspections, you know, by us or our designee, and that those have to be able to go any place, including military installations. Without those two elements, a deal is simply not going to work. Would you two agree with his assessment or not?
I certainly think that a good deal, and I'll go back to what the president said, which is absolutely true, which is no deal is better than a bad deal, but a good deal has to be verifiable. I want to add that with respect to Iran, you raised the question, and as I said, Iran is up with ISIL are the two big challenges to the stability of the Middle East and to U.S. interests associated with the Middle East. And our role in the nuclear negotiations is we're not part of the negotiations per se. We don't sit at the table. I have the responsibility to make sure that the military option is real. And believe me, we work on that and to make that real. Second, we have the responsibility to have the posture in the region that we do to check Iranian influence. And then last, we're very committed to the defense of Israel. So we have a big role in this picture in defense. It's not part of the negotiation, but it's a very, very big role, and we take it very seriously.
The only thing I'd add, Congressman, is as I've had these discussions with regional partners and most recently my Israeli counterpart, if there's a deal, I've got work to do with them. And if there's not a deal, I've got work to do with them. And we're committed to doing that work.
Thank you both.
Ms. Tsongas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank both of you for being here today. It's great to have you here. And I think it's particularly important for us on this committee and in this body to hear from both of you this week, as the House will today consider a resolution regarding ongoing U.S. operations in Iraq and Syria. I imagine you're aware of it. It has been nearly 1 year since the President outlined his plan to counter the threat posed by ISIL, a war he is waging based on authorities that have not been debated by Congress in 13 years. And since the President announced his plan to defeat ISIL, the United States has spent nearly $9 million a day, or nearly $3 billion overall. And at this rate, it will continue. Meanwhile, regional partners are pursuing efforts in Iraq and Syria that may not be in concert with those of the United States. And all of this has happened without a robust debate in Congress about the U.S. strategy, although we're starting to have that here today, the cost, which we have not yet addressed, and the end state in Iraq and the greater region. And I believe it's a debate that is long overdue. But I appreciate very much that you are here today, and General Dempsey, we will miss you. I have always appreciated how forthright, how very thoughtful you have been in our discussions about not just what we're doing in the Middle East, but more broadly across the globe. So I have a question for you that really, I'd ask you to think back a bit, because 10 years ago this fall, you assumed responsibility for a time for training, equipping, and sustaining the Iraqi security forces. But after over a decade of training, as we know, most of the Iraqi army remains a hollow force, and we're still challenged with that. With 450 new American advisors being sent to Iraq, and with your unique perspective in mind, how is today's American train and equip strategy adapting to make sure that we are not again standing up a force that will fold in the face of stiff resistance? Is it just enough that we are going to now seek to recruit Sunnis into it? I think it's much more complicated than that. So what are the lessons learned that give you confidence that these efforts will prove successful as you leave your very unique place in the American military effort?
Thank you, Congresswoman. I have a couple of thoughts. One is in terms of the strategy in general. I think our strategy matches the complexity with which we're dealing. That if you don't remember anything else I've said today, I think you should remember that the strategy matches the complexity. This is not a simple environment in any sense of the word. And to Ranking Member Smith's point earlier about where it would seem inconceivable to us that the Sunni wouldn't coalesce around the fight against ISIL, the reality is that some of our Sunni partners, both outside Iraq and in, are more worried about the Shia and Iranian hegemony than they are about ISIL. And so that's the environment, first. Second, I mentioned earlier we're trying to build a network. And that network, which will include all the stakeholders I described earlier, will be somewhat fungible from plan A to plan B, if necessary. And I think that's an important point to remember as well. So reaching out to the Sunni tribes is a very prudent, and by the way, we're doing it at the request of Prime Minister Abadi. It was his demand signal. Incidentally, there was some discussion that this was a knee-jerk reaction to the fall of Ramadi. We've been planning this for months. And we're looking at other locations as well where we can continue to build this network, which will be applicable to Plan A and in support of Plan A, but also accessible to us if Plan B becomes necessary.
You've mentioned in the past that this is a generational fight, that you don't see this being resolved very quickly. Any words of advice, again, as you are leaving, as to how we adapt over time to the fungible, changing environments? Any thoughts?
Oh, that's the thought, actually. You articulated it, which is that I think increasingly we've got, as I mentioned in our session where we talked about risk, we've got, for the first time in my 41 years, we've got states whose capabilities, I don't know about their intent, but I know that they have capabilities that could threaten us, and we have to deal with that. And we have non-state actors who, their intent is clear, their capabilities are less clear, and we better find a way forward. And by the way, some of that includes budget certainty, so we can build ourselves a military that can deal with both kind of threats, and then be adaptive when we get it wrong. And the key to adapting is actually leader development, and nobody does that better on the planet than we do.
Thank you. I wish you the best of luck.
Mr. Franks.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Secretary Carter and Chairman Dempsey. I want to add my personal gratitude on behalf of my children for your noble and lifelong commitment to the cause of human freedom and the future of it. Secretary Carter, you know, it's been observed and highlighted in several different mediums recently that the Kurdish strategy seems to be the one that is working in almost anyone's mind. It seems to be very effective. Yesterday afternoon, I had the privilege of hosting Shirko Abbas, the president of the Kurdistan National Assembly of Syria, in my office, and he was very open and honest about the strength of the Kurdish people, around 40 to 50 million spread throughout Turkey, Iran, Iraq, and Syria. And he estimated that approximately 150,000 Kurdish fighters could be ready once called, but he emphasized that their greatest limitation was not the number of fighters, but their equipment, their ammunition, the things that they need just in terms of hard support. And I guess my first question to you is, I'd like to know if the reports are true that the administration lobbied against an effort in the Senate NDAA to directly arm the Kurdish Peshmerga, and if so, why? And what is the Defense Department doing to ensure the funds and equipment and weapons that we have to send will actually make it into the very committed, capable, and effective hands of the Peshmerga?
Thank you, Congressman, and you're right. Committed, capable. The Kurdish forces are what we aspire to with respect to their Iraqi security forces in general. They show the will to fight. They show the capability to fight. I pointed earlier to their seizing, just in past days, one of the critical lifelines of supply to ISIL. So they're effective not only in protecting and defending their own region, but in the larger campaign to defeat ISIL. So we are supporting them from the air. We are supporting them in with equipment, to get to your point. I met with Mr. Barzani a few weeks ago. We went through the various categories of weapons, and it's very substantial that we're providing. I should note that we're not the only ones. In fact, some of the ones, the systems that the Kurds have gotten that they valued most actually have come from our European allies, and that's good. That shows everybody's in the fight. But we're committed to supporting the Kurdish forces. The reason to do the angle shot, so to speak, through the government of Iraq gets back to trying to foster and support a single multi-sectarian Iraqi state. We've all discussed the challenges of that. The chairman just alluded to that, but that's the policy. And what we said is, let's do that. But then we've turned to Baghdad and said, but you can't slow this down. And in the earlier days, they were slowing it down. And now it's getting directly to the Kurds, not only our stuff, but some of the stuff that's coming from Europe and elsewhere, which is very valuable, because these guys really do fight.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate that, and I understand the policy bank shot, as you call it, but I'm concerned that maybe we're not putting enough English on it. So I hope we'll continue to work in that direction. The deadline, General Dempsey, for the P5+1 nuclear negotiations with Iran is weeks away, and the perception is that the U.S. is entering into a deal with Iran. It's already, in my judgment, and many others, kind of had a grave effect on China and Russia as they watch our superpower, in their minds, capitulate to a lesser power. And I'm afraid that Saudi Arabia, you know, is considering its nuclear future, and that the U.S. appears weaker with every step forward that ISIS takes. And I know that these are policy decisions on the administrative level and not at your level, but a near-term decision like this could have much greater implications across the Middle East, as you know better than anyone, than any of us could almost imagine. How is the administration and the department ensuring that we balance both the near-term ISIS threat with the long-term Iranian threat, and what effects on the ground do you foresee this injection of the Iranian economy with billions of dollars that they might continue sponsorship of terrorism, or what effect is that going to have? And are we really doing what we need to do here?
That's not a 10-second question, Congressman, but I'll give you a 10-second, or now a 5-second answer. It's what I alluded to earlier, where we have state threats and we have non-state actors. ISIL strategy is the subset of a global strategy that actually I'd be happy to lay out for you.
Time, gentlemen, is expired. With this many members, we have to try to hold to the 5-minute rule. Ms. Duckworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, General Dempsey, again, congratulations, General Dempsey, on your upcoming retirement. And I just retired myself. The water's fine. Jump on in. I don't have anywhere near your years of service, though. I do want to address the fact that I continue to have some real reservations about our mission to train and equip the Syrian opposition forces, specifically the vetting process, our ability to differentiate between the numerous factions, to properly oversee the mission, and to know whether those that we are training and equipping are actually working in support of U.S. goals and our mission long term. I understand that after some delay, the training of the first cohort has officially begun. My reservations remain, namely our ability to effectively identify those who can be trusted, who can be counted on, who will work towards achieving our goals. And now that the training is underway, I'm concerned about a range of other issues, like what happens to the U.S.-trained rebels when they come under attack from ISIS fighters or from forces loyal to Assad. Could you please elaborate on the process for vetting and supplying the rebels and what kind of support they will receive? Also, what is our long-term commitment here? If they're armed with U.S. Caliber weapons, for example, have we committed us to long-term supply of NATO caliber bullets? They're not using AK-47s, so who's providing those NATO caliber rounds, 5.56, 7.62, and the like? I just want to make sure that we know how such a small group of rebels won't be able to tip the, you know, what their objectives will be, how do we measure success, et cetera. Mr. Secretary, could you start?
Sure, and there's it's a very excellent question, the Syria Train and Equip program is even more challenging than the Iraq Train and Equip program for the reasons you cited, namely, we are trying to recruit and identify people that, as you put it, can be counted on, that is, to fight, to have the right mindset and ideology not be aligned with groups like ISIL on the one hand, and on the other hand, as you put it, work towards our goals, our goal being for them to fight ISIL in the first instance. Mm-hmm. It turns out to be very hard to identify people who meet both of those criteria. General Nagata is trying very hard to identify such people, and then you raise yet another question, which is when we equip them and set them loose, what responsibility do we have for them thereafter? I believe we have some obligation to support them and protect them, including supply them, but then there will be questions raised, I'm sure, including by members of this committee, where did any of the stuff we give them get diverted? And that's always hard. You know, if we're dealing with the Iraqi security forces, we're dealing with the government's security forces. We have a little more experience keeping control over their equipment and so forth. With these these people we're trying to recruit in Syria, it's going to be much trickier. So these constraints that we put on ourselves, which are perfectly understandable, do progressively limit the number of inductees into the program, and that's proving the thing that limits the growth of the program. We have enough training sites and so forth for them. For now, we don't have enough trainees to fill them. Let me ask the chairman wants to add anything.
Thanks, Congressman. Thanks for your service. You know, whenever I talk to veterans, they consider themselves fortunate to have you here. So thank you. I share your reservations. You know, this is challenging. This is, as the Secretary said, more challenging even than in Iraq, but it's the necessary step to try to have some credible ground partner. We've got some experience supporting the YPG and their efforts around Kobani and elsewhere on the Syrian-Turkish border. The kind of support that's under consideration is command and control, logistics, intelligence, and close air support. No decisions made because we haven't reached the point where we're about to deploy them. We have had some challenges recruiting and retaining. We're trying to work through those. And as I said, we have a template that we have applied elsewhere that we think is applicable, and particularly if you want to keep them in the fight. And those decisions will be made here sometime within the next couple of months.
So at what point is there diminished returns? I mean, if you have so few recruits that can meet all these criteria and the commitment is so great, is it worth it to continue this policy of training and equipping the Syrian rebels?
Well, I think for now we're just literally at the first iteration or tranche of this, so it's a little too soon to give up on it. The alternative, by the way, is to try to find groups within Syria, which is itself a challenge to partner with. But we got to partner with somebody.
Thank you,
Mr. Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Secretary Carter. Chairman Dempsey, thank you so much for your service. I want to go to your comments that you've made about the lack of success, overall success, with Iraqi forces against ISIS. And you talked about some of the shortcomings of the Iraqi forces, whether it's their command and control, their capability, their will to fight. Let me ask, there's been some suggestions that there are more things that we can do with our forces from an operational perspective, from additional enablers, things like flying more air cover, special operations forces in targeted areas, more forward air controllers, better ISR, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance, training and advising at the battalion level, and even the assertion that it may be better for us to put in certain ways more of our troops on the ground in addition to other Arab nations that have interest along with us, countries like Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, in a greater combined force on the ground. Give me your perspective. We've heard from you about where the shortcomings of the Iraqi forces are. Give us your perspective on the current strategy. Is there more that we can do from an operational and support aspect with our efforts?
Thank you. To get to the first part of your question, how have the ISF performed, the honest truth is it's mixed. Mm-hmm. Some units, like their counterterrorism forces, have fought admirably and relentlessly, almost to the point of exhaustion, over the past months. Others have dissolved and collapsed, as I indicated. So it's a very mixed story. And Furthermore, the Iraqi security forces had increasingly become a Shia force rather than a Sunni force, sure, which is precisely why the people of the Sunni part of Iraq didn't feel like they were protecting them and that it was their army. And they need to come back into that feeling if we're going to have, as we've said, the multi-sectarian state. To get to your question, when we have capable Iraqi ground forces like the kinds we're trying to build at Takadum, your question is, what kind of support will we provide them? We're certainly committed to providing intelligence support and advice and assist support. With respect to introducing more forces on the ground with them, is something that we will, I think, need to revisit as those forces are actually produced. Once we have a capable, motivated force, what can we do to enable and support it? I like your idea of involving not just us in that, but our role is to be an enabler, a motivator. The chairman used the word leadership, and not a substitute for a capable ground force, but an enabler of a ground force, and that's where we'd like to get to.
Gotcha. All right. Chairman Dempsey.
Thanks, Congressman. The words to keep in mind are that our strategy, besides matched to the complexity, is also transregional. We're talking today mostly about Iraq and Syria, but as you know, ISIL has tentacles out in other places. And it's got to be sustainable over time. And that's, I think, the point to carry away here. So let's take ISR, for example. We've got about 50%, almost 50% of the global resource in ISR, unmanned, committed into the Iraq-Syria sector. That's a heavy lift. And so to suggest, and by the way, the rest of it is reacting to European security, to issues related to Iranian aggressiveness in the Strait and over in Yemen, to issues in the Pacific. And so, and Afghanistan, of course, where we still have 10,000 troops committed. So we're trying to find a way to make this a sustainable effort, which means by, with, and through partners. We're trying to provide our unique capabilities, but to your meaning, that which no one else can provide. But we, of course, are looking at points, discrete moments for limited objectives, for offensive operations, where we might provide an additional boost to the Iraqi security forces. But I'd be very reluctant. That's probably not the right word. I get accused of being reluctant often. My military judgment would be that introduction of those resources should not be done on a habitual basis, because we really want them to understand that this is their fight, but rather for moments where it would be strategically significant, potentially, for example, an assault on Mosul.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, in the 9 lines of effort that comprise our strategy, the first one that you cited is political. And you said that every other line of effort follows from that. We must be successful politically if we're going to be successful at all in any of the other lines of strategy, and if we are going to achieve our goals in the region. You gave as an example in your opening testimony building governance. Can you tell us where we have built governance in that region successfully? And this follow-up question to that is, how long will that take, since everything follows the success of that first line of effort?
It's a very good question. It's a very complicated task, and in Iraq, it'll mean when helping the Iraqis, helping them when they recover territory from ISIL, to build a system of governance that the people who live there support and are willing to support and defend in the long term. You say, where have we had success? My own view is we've had considerable success in Afghanistan. I was just speaking to President Ghani yesterday morning. He was reporting the results of the campaign there. Again, the Afghan security forces, which we are enabling, which we trained and equipped and are enabling, the National Unity Government of President Ghani and CEO Abdullah Abdullah, which is a multi-sectarian government holding together. This in Afghanistan, which I think if you go back 15 years, would say a very unlikely place for that to be done. So now we have assisted and enabled that. Our people are very good at that. We're not at that stage yet in Iraq, but when we get to that stage, I think that we will participate in an international effort to help these places that are tragically demolished to rebuild themselves and govern themselves.
So 15 years in Afghanistan to get to a successful example of building governance in this region, and including the fact that we've been in Iraq in one form or another since 2003, invested tens of billions of dollars to assist in building governance, trained and equipped an army that melted in the face of the enemy. I have some serious reservations about the potential to achieve success on this first line of effort. The third line of effort that you mentioned is helping to produce a capable, committed local ground force. You admitted that we had budgeted to train and equip 24,000, have only been able to recruit 7,000. You add to that the only ground forces apart from the Iraqi army are the Shia militias funded and led and armed by Iran. Is this a serious proposal? Is this a serious line of effort that we can seriously expect to succeed, given the most recent failures and your admission that the Iraqi National Army lacks the will to fight?
Well, it's a serious effort, but it hinges upon Sunni fighters coming into the Iraqi security forces, being trained and equipped by us and the coalition, enabled by us, but fighting for their homeland. That's the essential ingredient. That was absent starting last summer. It was quite clearly absent. Not everywhere, because earlier we talked about the Peshmerga. I mentioned the CTS and other units of the Iraqi security forces that did fight. And as you indicate, there are Shia militias, which we don't support. We only support those that fall under the government of Iraq as part of our overall strategy of supporting a multi-sectarian government there. So that is the strategy. It's difficult. I think the gap between 7,000 and 24,000, the whole point of Takadum is to try to close that gap, because we're trying to close that with Sunni fighters. That's the essential ingredient, and I think we're going to get on track to close that gap, and that's important.
In an exchange earlier, one of my colleagues and you had agreed that one of our primary missions is to support soldiers and families. I can think of no greater way of supporting them than ensuring that we have a strategy that can succeed when we're going to place them in harm's way and acknowledge that many of them will lose their lives or have their lives changed irrevocably upon return. So I hope there's a plan B from the administration. I yield back.
I amen to that. That's yet another reason why they deserve, as you deserve, a clear explanation of what we're trying to accomplish.
Dr. Fleming.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, gentlemen, for your service. Secretary Carter and General Dempsey, thank you for your service to our beloved nation. I do have some questions about what's happening in Iraq. Your 9 points or 9 lines that you talk about, Secretary Carter. Most of them are non-kinetic, such things as intel and messaging, counter-messaging, and that sort of thing. But General Dempsey, you said the other day that with regard to Ramadi, that the city itself is not symbolic in any way. So the question is, what factors on the ground would change? And this is a question for both of you. You can volunteer each other on this. But what would change on the ground in Iraq that would change our strategy, particularly in a more kinetic way?
There is in one's thinking a the question, what if a multi-sectarian Iraq it turns out not to be possible? I think the chairman addressed that. I just agree with what he said earlier. It was in response to what Congressman Smith asked. That is an important part of our strategy now on the ground. If that fails, then if that government can't do what it's supposed to do, then we will still try to enable local ground forces, if they're willing to partner with us, to keep stability in Iraq. But there will not be a single state of Iraq. And at the same time we're doing that, I think the other nine lines of effort signify that we, while we're working on this challenging situation on the ground in Iraq, we are trying to protect ourselves and contain the threat.
But to be more specific in my limited time, let's say that the capital, Baghdad itself, is in danger of falling. The entire government could be toppled. Would that change our on-the-ground strategy? Would it change the extent to which we use kinetic activity?
I'll ask the chairman to comment on this as well. I don't see that particular scenario change on the ground is very likely, for the reason that Prime Minister Abadi, one of the steps he has taken is to surround Baghdad with much of the remaining Iraqi security forces. And secondly, many of them, as I've noted, are Shia in sectarian orientation, and therefore are likely to fight fiercely for that part of Iraq. Therefore, I think that's unlikely, but that's the chairman for his military judgment.
Thanks, Mr. Secretary. That's why we're there right now. I mean, the threat to Erbil was what drew us into the kinetic portion of this fight, as well as the threat to Baghdad and the fact that we have our diplomatic presence there in the form of our embassy and thousands of American citizens. So, I mean, look, we will always protect our national interests unilaterally. And in fact, some of the recent special operations strikes and some of the other kinetic strikes that you've seen us conduct, both manned and unmanned, and let's not forget that in terms of our kinetic action, these 1,650 pilots that are flying in and out of Iraq and Syria know how very dangerous it is should they ever find themselves with an engine failure, not least a shot from an air defense weapon. So we are very active kinetically. The question I think you have is, would something cause us to be more kinetic? Obviously, it would be a credible intel of a threat to the homeland or credible intel of a threat to our facilities and persons. But for the day-to-day ISIL fight, we're relying upon coalition partners.
And in limited time, I think you've segued into my next question, and that is, what if the homeland is hit hard, such as 9/11? Would that change our strategy in Iraq, and in what way?
I suspect so, actually, but the fundamental strategy today is to prevent that from happening and to have an enduring outcome. If you're suggesting that could we go in and do a better job ourselves against ISIL, absolutely. But we'll be back there 2 years from now.
Thank you.
Mr. Pekaya.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, General Dempsey and Secretary Carter, for coming today and also for your service to our country. In February, the President submitted an AUMF to Congress that we never put to a vote. I believe that we must have a full and open debate on the ongoing operations in the Middle East. Given the ever-changing situation, has there been any thoughts to updates or changes to the AUMF measure since it was submitted? For example, is there more clarity on the phrase enduring offensive ground combat operations?
Thank you. I'll answer that. The very question that the chairman and I asked ourselves about the AUMF now several months ago, and I actually testified about the AUMF, asked ourselves two questions. One was, did this give us the needed flexibility and authority to conduct the campaign that is necessary? And the second is, would its passage clearly signify to our people that that our people, meaning our men and women in uniform and the other members of the Department of Defense, that the country is behind them in this fight. Those are the two things that are important about the AMF to me. The features that the first question is affirmative for me in the version that the president submitted, because it was flexible or broad in its definition of ISIL and the enemy, so to speak, because it was not geographically limited, because we know ISIL is geographically limited. It had the three-year piece in it, which is not anything to do with the military campaign. I can't tell you that in 3 years the campaign against ISIL is going to be over. The 3 years in the AOMF is recognition of our constitutional system, the fact that there'll be a new president and that Congress and the new president ought to be able to revisit a strategy seems reasonable to me, but it's not really a military thing. The only restriction within it is about long-term, large-scale offensive combat operations, which we judge, for all the reasons we've been describing earlier today, are not part of our strategy and we don't think are going to be needed to combat ISIL. Therefore, I'm okay with that provision in the AMF the president has submitted. So those are the questions we asked ourselves, and on both of those grounds, I hope that it will pass. I can't say whether it's legally necessary in any sense, but I think it would show support for the troops, and in that sense is a good thing.
All right. And for Secretary Carter again, last week an additional 450 troops were deployed in support of Operation Inherent Resolve. However, you have said personally that, and I quote, we can do nothing that we can substitute for the Iraqi forces' will to fight. And following the fall of Ramadi, you also made similar comments. I think you made comments as well today. I think many of us here in Congress are gravely concerned that the administration is considering committing a substantial American ground force to the ongoing efforts to combat ISIS, as it has been 10 months and we have slowly seen a ramp up of U.S. forces in Iraq and Syria. Are options being considered to redeploy a substantial ground combat force to the region to combat ISIS? If not, at what number will the line be drawn for American forces in Iraq? I think we all want to know, how does this end, and where do we draw the line on American involvement in this conflict?
The essence of the strategy is not to have U.S. forces substitute for capable and motivated local forces, but to have U.S. and coalition forces enable those forces. And the reason for that is that that's the only way to get a lasting result. American forces, outside forces, can combat, but when then it comes time for them to sustain the victory, and that can only be done by local forces. That's the reason why our strategy is not to put in 100,000 American troops. It is to put in smaller and carefully selected groups that can have unusual leverage. That's the point about Takadum. It's not about the number of people that are there. It's the leverage they're going to have. They're right in the middle of Sunni recruiting territory, and we want Sunnis, and it's right in the middle of where the Anbar Operations Center is that we can help the Iraqi armed forces.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, General Dempsey, I want to thank you so much for your decades of dedicated service to this country. And although I certainly feel that you've earned that retirement, we will miss you. I think this country will miss your service to our country. There is a position of this government of no boots on the ground. And I just want to drill down to what that means, because I agree that we shouldn't have U.S. military personnel back in Iraq as the ground component, maneuver element, taking the fight away from the indigenous forces there, Iraqi security forces. But I also have a concern
about that definition in terms, I do feel that there ought to be some U.S. military personnel forward with Iraqi forces, forward air controllers to make sure that we have effective close air support, advisors, not simply behind the wire, but with the Iraqi units. I served in Iraq with the Marine Corps, and what I noticed in going out and joint patrols in the Western Euphrates River Valley was that it really emboldened the confidence of those Iraqi soldiers. And so what is the position of the administration right now? Because I have heard critics complain about the effectiveness of our close air support in terms of the number of missions and the effectiveness of those missions, number of sorties and the effectiveness of those sorties. General Dempsey.
Thanks, Congressman. On this boots on the ground issue, I don't know what the administration's position is long term. I can give you my military judgment here today, and that is that I would not recommend that we put U.S. Forces in harm's way simply to stiffen the spine of local forces. If their spine is not stiffened by the threat of ISIL on their way of life, nothing we do is going to stiffen their spine. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, when they become offensive, and as a military man, you'll understand the distinction between defense and offense. When they go on the offensive, and if there's a strategic target, and we want to ensure that they succeed in achieving that strategic target, it could be a major city, it could be oil refinery, I would certainly take General Austin's advice and go to the Secretary of Defense and have that conversation about how we could make the chances of success better, but not just to stiffen their spine. In terms of the success of the air power's limitation is not about forward air controllers or JTACs or U.S. servicemen and women forward. It's about the intermingling of a significant number of groups. So in any particular place, let's take Ramadi, you'll have the intermingling of the Iraqi security forces, conventional, maybe their counter-terror forces, which are special operators, some elements of the Shia militia, some of which are actually working on behalf of the country of Iraq, some of which we are very concerned about, and tribes. And so we're very precise and very deliberate about the use of air power so that we don't actually undermine our own campaign of trying to focus this effort on ISIL.
And just because you asked about the administration, I want to put the chairman in that position. I agree with everything the chairman has said and am open to that judgment in the future. What we need, however, is a Iraqi ground force. Then we can provide the leverage for them, again, not just to stiffen their spine, not to substitute for them, but to leverage them. The last thing I'll say is there are boots on the ground in Iraq. We think about them every day. I appreciate any of you that visits them. They're not just in Baghdad. They're around the country. But the job they're doing is to build this capable and motivated ground force that, yes, as you say, we can then leverage. Okay. And we'll revisit that question when we have the ground force to enable.
Well, let me make sure I understand both of your positions. And that is, if forward Iraqi forces are in contact with ISIS or enemy elements, close air support would be effective in terms of influencing that battle, influencing the battlefield, shaping the battlefield, then in fact you would support U.S. military personnel forward with Iraqi units in the form of, say, forward air controllers.
We'll take that one for the record, Congressman.
Okay. Mr. Moulton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you both for your service and for being here. General Dempsey, when I walked into your office in Baghdad as a lieutenant, and you tried to figure out how a lieutenant was supposed to report to a three-star, you proved to me that you're not only a great national leader, as you have demonstrated for the entire country, but you're also a very good boss. And I'm grateful for being able to serve with you, as well as have you lead our country in so many important ways. So thank you very much. When you say, Mr. Secretary, that putting U.S. combat troops on the ground is no substitute for local forces, because only local forces will produce enduring results. My concern is that the plan that we are really executing now as far as training local forces does not look materially different than what we were doing some time ago. It's a much smaller scale. And I think that the missing component here is really an enduring political plan to ensure that the Iraqi government can hold itself together, because ultimately it's really a political failure in Iraq today, and I think we all agree on that. So talking about how important this first line of effort is, building a more effective, inclusive, multi-sectarian governance in Iraq, I'm concerned by my experience on the ground there when I visited in February, because I didn't see a single American commander on the military side who knew anything about a political plan. When I talked to the U.S. ambassador in Baghdad, his position was essentially that it's up to the Iraqis, it's not for us to influence. But it's not about us influencing it or a sovereign Iraq state, it's about either us influencing Iraqi politics or Iran influencing Iraqi politics. It concerns me as well, frankly, Mr. Chairman, when you say that you don't know what the administration's long-term plan is, because if we don't know what the long-term plan is, then I'm not sure it's worth putting these troops at risk in Iraq today. At a personal level, the most frustrating part of going back to Iraq in February was seeing so much of what we had fought for and achieved during the surge really gone to waste. And I want to make sure that we do have a long-term, enduring political plan so that whatever effort is made by these 450 and others on the ground in Iraq today, it doesn't go to waste and we don't find ourselves sending troops back again 5 years from now.
I just want to make sure, because I didn't intend to imply that I don't know what the administration's plan is. I think we've tried to lay that out. What I meant to suggest was that as this military campaign has evolved, when we have approached the administration for additional resources within the context of the strategy, they've taken our advice in every case. I just haven't gone forward yet with any further recommendations.
I want to just second that, and that's kind of the answer to Mr. Kaufman's excellent question as well. With respect to your also excellent question, that reinforces that the first line of effort is essential, the first line of effort being a Iraqi government that will not behave the way Maliki's government did. That is something we can influence. We don't directly control, but we can influence. And that's why the first line of effort and the second and third, why I'm so intent, and I know the chairman is, on aligning the political with what we're trying to do.
So, Mr. Secretary, what are we doing to influence it? And I can, just to drill down to a specific, what are we doing specifically to counter Iranian political influence on the ground in Iraq today?
Well, we have made it clear to Prime Minister Abadi and all the parties there, and they have supported the point of view that we are not going to support militias or Shia forces supported by Iran or otherwise constituted that are not under the control of the Iraqi government. So the ones that we're going to support and the ones that we're going to enable, and therefore the ones that we intend to be successful as part of our strategy, will be under the control of the government of Iraq, and they'll be the successful forces.
And are they responding to that leverage? Because I spoke with the Iraqi ambassador last week, and he said the difference between America's support and Iran's is that they have a house on fire. America comes with these conditions, get fire insurance, and we'll support you. Iran just shows up in with a fire extinguisher. And his view is that they're being much more effective at leveraging Iraqi politics today.
Well, we have spoken to Prime Minister Abadi and the members of his government about precisely this point, and he is asking for our help. Now, does he speak for everybody in Baghdad? No, but he is asking for our help. He says he prefers our support.
Thank you both. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Hunter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, Mr. Secretary, thanks for being here. I guess, I don't know, they've been asking about ISIS pretty hot and heavy here, so we'll keep it in the Middle East. You're familiar with, about 2 years ago, I asked Secretary Hagel to institute a hostage policy review. I asked him to appoint a hostage point person for DOD. It ended up being Mike Lumpkin, who's now ASD Solik. And Secretary Hagel did that, appointed Mike Lumpkin. The White House instituted a hostage policy review. All of this came about because things were brought to my attention by a Lieutenant Colonel Amerine, Special Forces soldier, fought in Afghanistan, was working in a section of DOD working on hostage policy and hostage recovery for DOD. He's now being investigated. He's being basically drummed out of the Army. You would not have a hostage policy review unless Secretary Hagel started it on his own without my request. I would not have requested it. You would not have had a hostage point person in Mike Lumpkin if it were not for Lieutenant Colonel Amerine. Senator Johnson wrote you a letter, I think, a few days ago asking you to look into Secretary McHugh, his investigatory policies within the Army, possible abuse by CID within the Army, and the case of Lieutenant Colonel Amerine in particular. So I would just ask you right now, I would just like your commitment that you would look into this, because none of this would have happened if it weren't for Amerine, who has now had to claim whistleblower status because he helped the United States fix its botched hostage recovery policy, of which we had none. I mean, we talked about this. You had FBI, state, DOD, and the intelligence communities all in their own lanes doing their own things for hostages. That's going to change now. You're going to have your own hostage policy now that review's underway. And the House and Senate, our NDAA was passed, that had the parameters for the administration's new hostage recovery policy set up in it. That's going to pass the Senate. So you're going to have that now. That would not have come about without the guy who's under investigation for making it all possible, right?
Congressman, I am familiar with the case. You have my commitment. It's under investigation now by the Inspector General. So I am familiar with the case. I can't comment on it because it's under investigation, but you have my commitment that I will keep in touch with that investigation as appropriate. You also have, I can't speak for the history, of course, but you certainly have my commitment with respect to a reasonable conclusion of the hostage policy review. And since the chairman may have been present at the creation of that review, if you'd like to comment, Chairman.
Yeah, Congressman, we can't comment on the investigation. We're both aware of it, and we're certainly enthusiastic to move ahead with the hostage rescue issue and make it more coherent across government.
Thank you. And I would just stress, I mean, one of the reasons the Army puts things under investigation is so you can't comment on it. I understand that's happened to me in the past. Number two, I would just ask that this, I think, is bigger than one particular service. I think that when you look at this case in particular and Jason Amerine and what he's done, he was in service to the entire country and to the Constitution, and he was doing his duty. And I think if you don't have... If you don't conduct some oversight on the investigation itself, the investigation of the investigation, I think we're not going to have the outcome that we should have, which is Amerine being cleared and not excoriated anymore, but being praised as someone who actually got something done within the system, even though they had to go outside of the system to us. And I would hope that every single one of those gentlemen sitting behind you all in uniform knows that if they can't work within the system, that they can come to Congress. I mean, that's what we're here for. Because when you're in the box, you can't always fix yourself. That's what we're here to do. So with that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Gabbard.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for your service and for being here with us today. We've heard a lot of discussion about this first line of effort that you outlined in your opening remarks to address the political and sectarian situation in Iraq. And I think it's important as we look at this question of what is our strategy to defeat ISIS, it's important that we operate in the world that actually exists, not the one that we hope or we wished could exist or would exist in the future. It's important to recognize that while these ideals are good to have, we're operating in the world that exists today. So even as we look at this administration's policy, the previous administration's policy, the billions of dollars and thousands of lives that have been spent
in holding on to this unified central government policy. Even as we hear rhetoric from Prime Minister Abadi, the reality is that experts, both who wear the uniform and those who have studied the Middle East for a very long time, all say for practical purposes, you have three regions in Iraq. It's a fractured country. With the Kurds in the north, the Shias have their stronghold in Baghdad, essentially, and you have the Sunni territories largely to the west. So when you look at this question and you look at Mr. Secretary, your answer to Mr. O'Rourke's question with regards to give us an example of how there has been a plan or there is a plan in place to allow for this and support governance and the ability for example, the Sunni tribes to secure themselves. And you talked about how this would happen in the future, help the Iraqi government put a plan in place for governance as territory is recovered. But my question goes to Krit. This is an offensive that took place not that long ago. I questioned before this occurred two members of the administration, what was the plan? And there was no plan at that time. And we saw as a result, once Tikrit was taken, Sunni families were terrorized by Shia militia, homes were burned down, businesses were looted. And as a result, you continue to see why these Sunni people have no motivation to go and fight for this so-called Iraqi security force, this Iraqi government, that shuts down bridges when they're trying to run away from ISIS. So as you say, it's essential Sunni fighters are brought into the fold. I think we all recognize that the Sunni people need to be empowered, but this is why there's no faith by many in Congress and the Sunni tribes, most importantly, that there is a plan in place to empower them.
I very much respect your expertise and your perspective on this. And one of my favorite sayings is hope is not a strategy. And this is a strategy, the particular part of the strategy which has to do with the integrity of the Iraqi state is a challenging one. No question about it for all the reasons you describe. It is, if it can be achieved, better than sectarianism in for the Iraqi people and for what we want, which is ISIL's lasting defeat. Is it difficult to achieve? Yes. Does it involve as an essential ingredient empowering the Sunnis and giving them the will to participate? Absolutely. Is Tikrit a good example of what we're trying to achieve? No, it wasn't. That's the whole point. That was not a ordered operation under the exclusive control of the Iraqi government. And it had the kind of aftermath that exactly incentivizes us to be trying to get Sunnis into the fight. Because if you put Shias into the Sunni fight, you know how that ends. That is not lasting defeat. So that's why we're trying to get the Sunnis into the fight. I think you are asking exactly the right question. I think it's more than hope. I think there's some reason, prospect that we can do this. We're determined to do it. There are plenty of Iraqis who say that they will support that strategy and that we can make it succeed.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I would just continue to urge the administration to consider changing its policy on supporting this government in Baghdad. You mentioned sectarianism is the problem. I would argue that this government in Baghdad is further adding fuel to the fire of sectarianism by allowing these Shia militia, by allowing this sectarian persecution and oppression to continue, which only allows further oxygen for ISIS to continue to exist and to continue to grow in Sunni territories. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bridenstine.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank the Secretary and the Chairman for coming and testifying today. I'd like to follow up on the line of questioning that we were just going down. You know, you mentioned earlier, General Dempsey, about General McChrystal, and you got to defeat a network with a network and his commitment to that. Certainly, he was also very committed to the counterinsurgency strategy that was deployed in Afghanistan. You were the deputy commander of CENTCOM when we employed counterinsurgency in Iraq, and I think you eventually became the acting commander of CENTCOM under the counterinsurgency policy. Would you, and my understanding is we employ that kind of strategy so that we can come to the diplomatic and political solutions that she was just talking about. The idea is that we have some space to maneuver so that parties can come together and we can come to a governing solution that is reasonable for all involved. Can you share with us your time there? Why was it successful? Why was the counterinsurgency strategy in Iraq successful?
Well, I think that the counterinsurgency strategy is effective when the lines of effort that the Secretary outlined at the beginning are applied, not just the military instrument. And as you know, in those years when there was not much else going on in the world, actually, we invested enormous resources into that effort. I don't think you're suggesting, I guess I should probably ask if you're suggesting whether we should make that kind of commitment again. Rather, it seems to me that we are trying to accomplish the objectives of a counterinsurgency, but adapting based on what we've learned to ensure that most of that lifting is done by regional partners and by the government of Iraq itself.
So I'm not suggesting that we return to counterinsurgency in Iraq. What does concern me, though, is we heard over and over again from this administration that we had to end the gains of the counterinsurgency because we didn't have a status of forces agreement. And the reason we didn't have the status of forces agreement, according to the administration, is that they couldn't get it ratified by the Iraqi parliament. We've heard that over and over again. Now somehow, even though we had to leave because we didn't have a status of forces, now all of a sudden we're putting thousands of troops back. Can you tell me today, do we have a status of forces agreement?
No, we do not, but we have diplomatic notes that guarantee the immunities and protections. And by the way, we've got 3,500 servicemen and women on the ground, so it's a much different order of magnitude.
So originally then, when we did the counterinsurgency, since there wasn't an Iraqi parliament, we didn't have a status of forces agreement, or was that just an exchange of diplomatic notes as well?
I don't know the answer to that. I can take that for the record. You're talking about back in 2011?
Right. My point is, if we can have an exchange of diplomatic notes and sustain the gains that we had from the counterinsurgency, I think it was Mr. Moulton that talked about the blood-bought gains. I mean, this is very difficult for us as a nation. If we can do that with an exchange of diplomatic letters, then why wouldn't we do that with an exchange of diplomatic letters instead of just saying, well, the Iraqi parliament won't ratify it, therefore we have to leave immediately. And then all of a sudden, everything that we fought to achieve, including me, including you, it seems to all be for naught. This is a lesson. We can't go back and unwind what has already happened, but we have to be cognizant of this as we go forward, because these kind of conflicts are going to happen again. And the commander-in-chief needs to make a decision that he doesn't get to change the policy that came before him. We have to make decisions that we inherit the policy from our predecessor. We have to make decisions in the best interest of our country, regardless of whether or not it was his war to begin with. That's my point in all this.
Yeah, the only thing I would add is that you'd have to concede we have a much different partner in Prime Minister Abadi than we did in Prime Minister Maliki.
That's correct. It was also true that Prime Minister Maliki would have wanted us to be there had we had the opportunity to do it with an exchange of diplomatic letters, which he wanted us to do, and instead we chose to reject that. With that, Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
Ms. Bordayo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Secretary Carter, and General Dempsey. You certainly have tremendous challenges on your shoulders, and I thank you for your service. Question that I'm going to ask, I think both of you may have comments on. As we've announced additional deployments of service members back to the Middle East to enhance the train and the equip mission, I've become really troubled about the effects it will have on the readiness of our total force. Instead of sending complete units, it appears that we're deploying piecemeal components and a disproportionate contingent of senior personnel. So I'm concerned that the portion of the unit
that remains at home station or in training will be relegated to preparing only for small unit operations instead of being able to train for full operations. Now, how will we mitigate this and ensure our reconstituting units will get the training they need to recover their readiness? That's the first part of the question. And secondly, also, will we consider changing the model for how we generate forces for small-scale operations?
Excellent questions, Congresswoman. Thank you. And I'll start and ask the chairman to pitch it as well. You're absolutely right. When we send in an enabling force, we tend to take certain elements, including the command element, out of a larger unit, a brigade or a division even, headquarters, and deploy it forward, because that's the only part of the force that we need, and the rest stays behind. That is a readiness dilemma for, in this case, the Army, and I know the Army works very hard on that, but it is as you say. And so the second part of your question is, are we thinking of ways of, I forget how you put it, but systematizing and dealing with the readiness
yes.
issues associated? Absolutely we are. I know that Secretary McHugh and General Odierno are. I've discussed that with them. Chairman, in addition to being the chairman, was also the chief of staff of the Army, and perhaps he'd comment as well.
Thank you.
Yes, Congressman. We are adapting our global force management process to account for the fact that, as I mentioned earlier, for the first time in a very long time, we have both the issue of dealing with potential threats from state actors and from non-state actors. So though it's always our instinct to apply coherent units, that is to say units that have been organized, trained, and equipped and had a long relationship with each other, We're going to have to find ways to account for our global challenges with a hybrid solution to global force management. But, you know, frankly, we are a much different Army, I'll use, in 2015 than we were in 2003 when this all began. And we can figure it out, but we'd be happy to describe for you how we intend to approach that.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Dr. Winstrup.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, both for being here. You know, as I sit here and we go through all this, I just can't help but reflect as one of the couple hundred thousand who served in Iraq and saw us go on to victory to just have my stomach turn when I think of my friends that were killed in certain areas that are now under control of ISIL. And it's very difficult to sit and watch what's taking place today. Today we have also a possibility of a resolution being brought forward that asks for the removal of all U.S. troops from Iraq or Syria. What do you think the Middle East would look like if we did that, and what effect would it have on our national security?
That would be a mistake, Congressman, for obvious reasons. We have both we have United States national security interests within Iraq. And we also have United States national security interest in maintaining credible, safe, and reliable allies in the region. And our withdrawal from this issue would challenge and put us at greater risk over time. No question about it.
I would agree with you on that note. I have another question concerning our counter-messaging and our humanitarian efforts. Obviously, I think those are key components to whatever military mission we're engaged in. Is it helping with the recruitment on the local level for our allies in this fight? Is our counter messaging having an effect? You know, we talk all the time about the messaging of ISIL and the social media, et cetera, et cetera. Is our counter messaging helping recruit those that will be in the fight with us?
The honest truth is that at the moment, our counter messaging is the truth. We don't have particular ways of getting on social media and propagandizing the way ISIL does, and I don't think you're suggesting that we should do that.
I'm asking you.
But we do.
You mentioned counter messaging earlier. I'm just asking you what that looks like.
Well, exactly, and I understand the drift of your question. And the critical form of counter messaging by America gets back to the word the chairman started with, which is leadership. When we step up and indicate that we're in the game, we're not substituting for the game, but we're in the game, whether it be here or anywhere else. I was just in Southeast Asia last week. There's a hunger for American leadership. We've played that role for decades in many parts of the world. Same thing is true in Europe. And I think that the best message we can give against all of these threats to our friends and allies is one of resolve and steadiness. Made an earlier reference to continuity over time. I think that's important as well, the steadiness of American leadership. And it gets back to all the things we had a conversation about the budget earlier. I believe we need steadiness there as well. And that's the best kind of, that for heartening our friends and getting them to do more, that's the best kind of counter message we
can. And what about the humanitarian side that was mentioned as well? I mean, I look at how we really turned the tide in Iraq before, and part of that was our humanitarian efforts, where I saw people of Iraq began to trust us more than their own government. And because of the way we lived with them, and we endured what they endured, and we offered medical relief and things like that. Are we doing things like that? Is that part of our humanitarian effort that wins over the hearts and minds of people that we need if we are going to be successful?
It is. I don't think we've had the full opportunity to deploy that. When we begin to take back territory, I think the gist of your question is we need to help the Iraqis who do that to restore services, make sure people are getting food, power, all these things that just make up normal life. That has to be the sequel to a military defeat of ISIL. Otherwise, the tide will just turn back again. And that's essential. And again, now we're not going to try to do that all by ourselves, but I think that we will, as we enable the fight, we need to enable the aftermath as well. And to get back to your part about partners and allies, many of the partners and allies are very willing to do that. And they have some experience in doing that, including in Afghanistan. Some of our European friends and allies, for example, will be very willing to. So it's not like the United States has to bear the whole burden there.
No, I agree. And I hope that we do deploy those measures, which can be helpful to us. Thank you. I yield back.
Mr. Ashford.
Yeah, thank you, Ms. Chairman. And thank you, General Dempsey, Ms. Secretary. On topic and probably has been asked and answered a couple of times, but when I was in Iraq with Congressman Moulton, and he asked the question that he asked today several times, and it's a compelling question. There was quite a bit of optimism when we were there in February. It had to do primarily with the fact that in June there would be a operation in Mosul and so forth and so on. One of the factors that but much has changed since then, obviously, and you've addressed that. One of the, for me, and what I reported back to Nebraskans was that I saw the emergence of, to some degree, leaders in the Arab countries who were ready to stand up and try to unify these groups in a less sectarian manner. And King Abdullah of Jordan was one of those. It was very, to me, at least someone who's new to this, it was very optimistic kind of a report. He talked about his idea of bringing Sunni leaders together in April or so, but since that time, obviously the Jordanians have been impacted by significant challenges, not the least of which are the refugees and some of the Al Qaeda issues for them. Number one, I guess my question, Mr. Secretary, would be how are things going with Jordan, and do you see that that sort of exceptionalist kind of approach that he was taking, being able to move forward. And I apologize if this has been asked before, but.
No, it's a key question. It was alluded to before, but you're hitting the nail on the head, which is where are the other, particularly Sunni aligned powers in the region in this fight, which is essentially for a big swath of Sunni territory by a group where religion is the center of their political ideology. And in the case of Jordan, there's no question about that. The level of insight and commitment by the king and the tremendous support he has in Jordan, in part because of the tragic burning of his pilot, right. He's all in and a very committed partner, and we're doing everything we can to work with him. The refugees are a challenge to a small country like Jordan, so definitely a worry. When we had the GCC countries here in Washington about a month ago, and they were raising issues in their region, including Iran, which they're very concerned about. Right. So we were talking about Iran as well, but we were also saying, hey, it's not just Iran. There's ISIL as well, and you are uniquely positioned to play a greater role in this campaign. They indicated some willingness to do so. I think at the moment we're trying to help them build the capacity to do so, because most of them don't have the ground forces that could participate in principle in the campaign in Iraq and maybe more acceptable than outsiders.
And obviously, at that time we were talking about the training mission, which is being undertaken, and you've talked about that, and you're doing more of that. To me, it seemed then, and that you can, and does now as well, listening, that you can, obviously there's a military objective, and that has to be followed through with, but there, it isn't, maybe I'm wrong, but it isn't so much that we have to wait until the military objective is absolutely done, that there's also a parallel course of bringing these other leaders together to try to find more political solution. It seemed to me when I left that was what I was hearing. It has to be parallel. You can't just go from one to the other. It has to be sort of a parallel thing. There's only a few seconds, but if you could comment on
it. Completely agree with that. All these another way of saying it is all the lines of effort of the strategy have to be synchronized, and the political and the military in particular need to be synchronized.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. McSally.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for sustaining for the long haul here today. I do want to say that I do have serious concerns about what appears to be an incoherence in our regional strategy related to Iran specifically, where we're marching towards a nuclear agreement with them, yet we're supporting Saudi Arabia as they're striking their influence in the Houthis in Yemen, yet Qasem Soleimani is leading the ground offensive to take back Tikrit while we're providing the Air Force. No wonder why our Sunni partners don't want to, you know, are concerned about the incoherence there. So I know a lot of that is your participants, but you're not fully responsible for. But I just want to, you know, say on the record that I think it's that incoherent strategy that's impacting some of the lack of commitment of our allies in the political nature, specifically in Iraq. But I want to focus my questions on specifically the targeting and the air campaign in Iraq. Just led a CODEL over to the region, met with the air component commander, met with the JTF leadership. They felt like ISIS was on the defensive, and then a couple weeks later, obviously, Ramadi fell. And I have been involved in the targeting process at the COCOM level down to the pilot. And so I am concerned, and I know you mentioned we were hitting all the targets we have, except for when collateral damage is a factor, General Dempsey. And I want to quote General Deptula's, who is the smartest guy on air power, I think, in our generation, op-ed in the Washington Post, and I'll do it quickly, a couple weeks ago. The fastest way to end the inhumanity of war is to eliminate its source, in this case, the Islamic State, as quickly as possible. Gradualism doomed the effectiveness of air power in Rolling Thunder air campaign in Vietnam. The current gradualist approach is worsening the suffering and increasing the loss of innocent life. While unintended casualties of war are regrettable, those associated with airstrikes pale in comparison with the savage acts being carried out by the Islamic State. What is the logic of a policy that restricts the use of air power to avoid the possibility of collateral damage while allowing the certainty of Islamic State crimes against humanity, is the question he poses. I think it's a very valid line of argument. If we're trying to avoid one civilian casualty, yet in not hitting a legitimate target, we're allowing the Islamic State to continue to commit atrocities and murder against the people on the ground, how do we balance that? So my question is, and you may need to answer this in a classified manner, what percentage of the strike sorties are coming back with their munitions on board as just an indication of kind of our limitations? And how many targets have we actually identified? We've gone through the PID, we've got a valid target, but we actually haven't struck them specifically because of the collateral damage limitations that are much tighter than the law of armed conflict requires, or because the approval process takes so long, we just are unable to hit it. So, you know, what's that number? How many are we not hitting their legitimate targets because of this extreme constraint that we're putting on for collateral damage?
First, for the record, let me tell you, I couldn't disagree more with retired General Deptul. And I would say that both as General Dempsey, as Chairman Dempsey, and at some point in the future, Citizen Dempsey.
Okay.
Okay. Secondly, the targeting that we do is based on intelligence, and we fuse, as you know very mm-hmm. well, we fuse UMINT, we fuse SIGINT, yeah. and we...
Some say we got the PID. We got the PID, but now we don't strike because of the CDE.
Right. That's right. And that decision is made by the commander on the ground. And
so do we have a number, though, that, you know, it's you know, 80% or 20% don't get hit because of CDE, not because of PID?
I would like to answer you in a classified version, because I think that we don't want to signal our enemies on how they might avoid being shot.
Well, it just gets to the indication of whether this is the thing that's really allowing us to not achieve our objectives.
In my judgment, this is not the limiting factor.
Okay, fair enough. The next question I want to follow up, we talked about it earlier. As you mentioned, we've got over 1,600 pilots flying every day, could have an engine issue, and then we've got a potential pilot being captured with the potential fate of the Jordanian pilot. As I was visiting the theater, visited some of our combat search and rescue forces there, but they remain outside Iraq primarily because of limitations of boots on the ground. And responsiveness is really important for combat search and rescue to be able to scoop them up right away. So we're allowing 450 more advisors to go in Iraq, but we're not allowing our combat search and rescue forces to go into Iraq. Have you advised the administration to move them there and they're not taking your advice, or are you comfortable with them being so far away with that increased responsiveness?
That's a great question. At this point, they are operating from locations outside of Iraq, and they can loiter, and we're not taking any more risk at that point. If we go into the point where we were going to accompany the Iraqi security forces, that will require not just, that's why it's important, you know this, but it's important to understand, this is not just about putting three JTACs forward,
mm-hmm.
it's about putting a medevac capability
right.
and a combat search and rescue, a personal recovery capability, and a QRF. And so 15 people might require 150.
Right, but one F-16 pilot deep into Syria needs that same responsiveness.
Right, but we've got PR in hand right now. If we expand this at some point, we'll have to address it.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very good questions. Mr. Norcross.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and somebody has to be last, and certainly appreciate your service. I just want to follow up. Right where you're sitting, we had King Abdullah probably here. Actually, it was the day after they released the video of his pilot being burned to death, and you can imagine his attitude. But he made a couple points that resonated with me through today. One is that this is our fight, indicating that it's not going to be a Christian or Muslim, that they had to fight. Certainly, they want our help, and we are doing that. But something that really stuck with me to this day is, I've been fighting this fight for 1,400 years. 1,400 years. So it sort of reminds me what we're following the steps here is, if anybody has been to an arcade, it's called whack-a-mole. You hit them here, they come up over here. This is the question I'm going to. What is considered a win? Much of the discussion today has been around Iraq, but those lines are simply lines on a map. This is about the Middle East. What do you see as a win? Is it geographically based? And is it short term? Where are we in 5 to 10 years? What is a win when we're discussing the Middle East, and in particular with ISIL?
Well, I think that, and this gets back to the previous question about how complex and varied are the problems of the Middle East. The way we ground ourselves and our strategy is in American national interests. And so in these different circumstances, we're trying to pursue our interests. Our interests in this particular fight against ISIL are to stop this movement from becoming something that endangers friends and allies and therefore our interests in the region, or that is capable of striking the homeland. So success in the campaign would be eliminating not every mole, as you to use your metaphor, but every mole hole, and make it such that there is no safe haven for the kind of savagery that ISIL represents, and from which it can continue to destabilize places like Jordan,
sure,
or even further afield. I think that's what we're trying to accomplish, and it's difficult, it'll take some time, but that's what the strategy is about in that particular region for that particular problem. But this is a varied region, and there are other problems as well. We've talked about Iran as a challenge, so this is one, but not the only one.
General, just to follow up on that, from a strategic planning perspective, we can take out the hole, as you mentioned, but don't we have to look at this long term? And we want to make sure you have the tools that are needed. But this is long-term, ongoing, because if we defeat them in one area, they're going to regather and come up in another area, thus the 1,400-year fight that the king was reflecting on. Do you see this as an ongoing?
Congressman, I absolutely do and have said so at every opportunity, that we need to, and that's why we need to put ourselves on a sustainable footing across this challenge that runs from Afghanistan and we could certainly argue all the way over to Nigeria. A sustainable footing that allows us to keep pressure on this network, to build partners to keep pressure on the network, and to make regional stakeholders who have a lot more to gain or lose than we do in the lead of it. And that's the path we're on.
So predictability from the America,
budget
that your friends are going to be there and continue to be
absolutely
here.
Absolutely. By the way, I don't want to turn it into a budget hearing, but predictability in a budget would help us accomplish that.
When we were over the UAE, that's what we're hearing, is they're seeing that America potentially could walk away from their commitment or their friends in the area, and that's the last thing we want to see. So predictability is the single most stabilizing force. Would you agree with that?
I'd say predictability and perseverance.
Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you. Gentlemen, I appreciate it. Ms. Secretary, the thing I wrote down that I kept thinking about throughout today was hope is not a strategy. And so I hope we have thousands of Sunnis who flood into the training that we're going to do, that get energized to go fight ISIL. But we've got a, there are concerns about whether they're going to do that and trust the central government. We have a provision in our bill that says unless you can certify that Iraq is an inclusive government, then we can directly arm the Sunni tribes and the Kurdish Peshmerga. Again, hope's not a strategy, and hoping for an inclusive Iraq with Sunnis joining the fight, I hope it happens. But if it doesn't happen pretty quick, obviously we can't have ISIS continue to grow. And then on a similar note, I would hope we would have defense budgets grow at a predictable 5 to 7% every year for the next 10 years. And not only y'all, but the industrial base could plan on that, and it would be a much better, more efficient system. On the other hand, we're not in that world right now, and if the president chooses to veto two defense bills, an authorization and appropriation bill that provide exactly as much money as he asked for, because he doesn't like the label on some of the money, or because he wants to put more money or leverage it for more money for the IRS or the EPA, that's going to have serious consequences for our military, because that'll mean we're at a CR for the rest of the year. And so I hope that not only you two who have to deal with the real world, but the president as well, can use hope not as a strategy, but look at the real world consequences of some of these decisions. Because as we've affirmed several times today, this is a very complex, long historical background of problems in this part of the world. We got to deal with it as we find it, not how as we hope it would be. Y'all are welcome to comment. You don't need to, but that's just my parting thoughts after having been here. Let me ask all.
I'd only say, Chairman, because it is my favorite phrase, that I think in this, as in every other part of the world, we need to be practical, and where practical, turn hope into reality. But practical, that's the meaning of that slogan, and I think I'm just echoing what you just said.
No, it's a great point, and how do you get from a hope to reality? It's a strategy, and that's why we had this hearing today, to talk about how we get from what we hope it will be from where we are today, and it looks like a long, winding, very difficult road in the Middle East. Let me ask all our guests to remain seated so that the Secretary and the Chairman and their party can make their way out. We've held you longer than we intended, and so if everybody will stay seated for just a moment while our witnesses depart. Again, thank you all for being here. We'll look forward to other engagements. With that, the hearing stands adjourned. Of this is going to achieve it. It's what we're trying to do. But so we're opening a new facility in a different part of Iraq to train, and we hope they come flooding in, and they will be trained and effective, and then we'll see if we can support them. I mean, it just doesn't give you a lot of confidence that this thing is on the right track.
So what do you want to hear? Do you want to hear them saying we're putting ground troops in for combat roles?
No, not necessarily. I mean, I think we had some excellent questions, especially from our combat veterans, about the way we are tying our own hands in the air, on advisors being able to go into the field, and so forth. So I'd like to try that. But as I mentioned at the end, we've got this. If Iraq cannot be an inclusive government, then we've got the provision in the bill to directly arm other, other groups in Iraq. And I think a lot of members, as you may have heard, are pretty much there. They're just not at all convinced the Iranians will let the Iraqi government be inclusive.
Secretary Carter has said that arming the Kurds in Iraq could push the central government closer to Iran.
Yeah, and then you'll have people say, can they get closer? I mean, I don't mean at all to disparage the intentions of what seem to be the intentions of Prime Minister Abbott. I mean, he's not Maliki. Yet, Iran seems very much in the driver's seat here. And that's part of the reason I've insisted in my question to ask about Iran's activities in the region. You can't just separate out Iraq, and as hard as that is to solve, and they admit Syria is harder than that, but you got to take into account what Iran is doing and their influences throughout this region. And by the way, I did not think that I got any sort of answer to, okay, what's your plan for dealing with Iran other than the nuclear issue? I mean, it was, and it's hard. I don't, you know, these guys are trying to do their best within the constraints that the White House lets them. But I don't have a lot of great confidence. So.
Where are we with this resolution about removing all these troops from Iraq and Syria? I don't get this resolution.
McGovern. You mean you don't get it? I mean, it was filed. It's coming to the floor today. There is a privileged status under the War Powers Resolution, which is what he filed it under. Now, we could get into a parliamentary debate about whether it's truly privileged or not, but leadership decided, let's just bring it up, vote on it up or down, and so that's what's happening today.
Why is it August 14th? There's a provision in there that they have to be removed before.
He just has a time frame to get out, I think.
There's no
but it is
magic.
Well, the War Powers Act has a time limit, 60 days or something like that.
That's when it runs out. Yeah. So all of this is filed under the War Powers Act. And if you file, if something is not authorized, as I understand it, you can file this under the War Powers Act for a vote that would then force withdrawal within 60 days.
So this isn't going anywhere.
I don't think it would. It will pass.
Okay.
Now, I continue to have the opinion we ought to have the debate and vote on authorizing the use of military force. So there's discussions about that. But that's not McGovern. This is just a straight up or down, you know, have to withdraw or not.
Got it. Do you think it's a real AUMF debate, like some people are saying it is?
I'm not sure I understand your question.
I mean,
McGovern is a U.S.
Right. Does it substitute?
No. Yeah. I do not think so. I think we ought to have a real AUMF debate. This is not it. This is withdraw now, regardless of the consequences. So, regardless of one's opinion on an AUMF or whether you think they have a strategy or not, I think a lot of people will not be prepared to do that.
Yeah. And where are we with that? Larger debate on authorization.
Lots of discussions, as I say, my opinion is we should have that debate, we should have that vote. You know, the concern, well, two concerns are here. One is we don't have a strategy. So you're expecting me to vote to authorize the use of military force when they don't have a strategy to be successful? It's a hard question to answer. The second thing you hear is, okay, what if we try to bring this up and vote and it fails? What does that say to our troops? What does that say to our allies? And that's a hard question to answer, too. On the other hand, part of my answer is that's what the Constitution says, even if it's difficult. And so, that's some of the back and forth among committees and leadership.
What happens if the NDAA is chosen by the president? What happens then? What do we do?
Oh, I don't know. We'll just take it a step at a time. I'm hoping that the Senate will pass it tomorrow, and I'm hoping we'll have a conference report quick, and I'm hoping that the president will sign it, not veto it. And if any of those things don't work out the way I hope, then we'll just take that as it comes. But I'm sorry, just to emphasize, he's going to veto a defense bill, whether it's authorization or appropriation, that provides him exactly as much money as he asked for? Just in the world that we're just described today, how does any of that make sense?
We're looking at the 1,200 pieces of heavy equipment going to Eastern Europe and the Baltics. Is that appropriated at all, or would it come out of contingency? I mean, it's being considered, so.
I don't know the answer. It would be operation and maintenance that would move it, because as I understand it, it's moving it from one location further to the east. So there would be some cost in rail or truck or driving, you know, transportation costs. That would be out of O&M cost, whether that is out of the OCO O&M or the base.
Do you have any thoughts about the...
Well, it is part of the contingencies of a dangerous world. And as you saw, a lot of what we have in the overseas contingency account is O&M funds. So, not just for the Middle East, but also for what's happening in the Far East and in the Eastern Europe as well.
On Syria, Carter said that there weren't enough people entering the program to send a force in to fight ISIL. Was that news to you, and is there any hope left for that program?
Hope is not a strategy. Isn't that the theme of the day? I don't know. He is not the first person who has said Iraq is easy compared to Syria. And I see little prospect of having a ground force that we train that can push back against ISIL in the near term. So what's happened recently is it's the Kurds who have made some gains in the north, and I appreciate that there's somebody there, you know, willing to fight. But the Kurds are not going to remove ISIL from Syria. You know, they're doing good work, but they can't do it on their own. So,
thank you.
All right, thank you all.
Thank you.
Good rest of your day.
Thank you. You too.
Yeah.